the Northampton City Council meeting of May 19th, 2016. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight. I will be presiding. As per our custom, we invite the public to come speak. And this is your forum at that before we convene. And you're allowed to expound on any topic for no more than 3 minutes, please. Because the reason we limit to 3 minutes is, as you can see, there are plenty of people who like to speak. And then we also have a really heavy agenda ahead of us, and we need to do the work that we were elected to. So the rules are that I will call your name off the sign-up sheet and come up to the microphone. You don't need to adjust the microphone. It's actually set for a wide parabolic range. It'll pick you up. And state your name and your address, and then and speak your piece. And there, you'll see a three-minute countdown, and it doesn't start until you identify yourself, and then the clock starts ticking. Please, I know you. Some of you may have written stuff that you thought timed out at 3 minutes, but you'll find that you're about two paragraphs away. Please surmise about the time at 3 minutes. Please just sum up what you're saying in one brief sentence, if you would, please. Also, you're not compelled to do this, but I would ask you, if someone has said something that you're saying, in the interest of time, maybe if you could think of something new, or just come up and say ditto, that would hold up for it. So, we'll get started, and we'll start with Siga. And I'm sorry, Siga. I don't know what you're. I can't pronounce your last name. I can't read the handwriting. You stand up and you correct my pronunciation of your name, please.
My name is Siga Pui.
Thank you, Siga.
And I live in Amherst, 39 Jeffrey Lane. Okay, so we've been working on talking about Columbus Day, and in class we talked about why we thought that we should probably change this. So the Native Americans are a core part of our country's history, and they were here first, and we should honor the indigenous people because of all the hardships they faced, the troubles they've been through, and also for the positive contributions they've made. The Native American people were here first and forced out of their homes, which left them to be forgotten. And by changing Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day, the Native American people will be recognized, and hopefully the rest of Massachusetts could follow. And other states and communities have adopted this holiday. And by seeing other places that have adopted this holiday, it is also helped to convince me and my peers to think that this is also a great idea.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Madeline Kruckmeyer.
She's not here.
Jim Galran.
My name is Jimmy Galvin, and I'm talking about the same thing Siga is talking about. So,
can you tell me where you're?
Oh, right. I live on One Prospect Court in Northampton.
Thanks.
In 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. He had three ships and left from Spain. He sailed through sunshine, wind, and rain. This is what young children are taught in school, read in books, and led to believe. All around the country, students are told of Columbus's greatness, his heroic deeds, but they are told nothing of the people who are here first, the ones who lived happily until Columbus took away their freedom and lives. After Columbus's arrival, they were pushed away from their rights and into the poverty that they still face today. Indigenous Peoples Day can help raise awareness for the problems that Native Americans face, and make sure that Indigenous people get the rights they deserve.
Thank you very much. And I also should note that when you're speaking, the council is not allowed to respond or speak back to you. So don't think we're ignoring you. Just I get to say thanks though. So thank you. Tom?
My name is Tom Wiener, and I live at 11 Linden Street, Northampton. I want to first thank Alyssa Klein for all she has done to bring the resolution regarding the celebration of Indigenous Peoples Day before the City Council this evening. I also want to pay tribute to the students who were the inspiration for the effort to come before the council back in November to ask for the resolution. I'd like their names read into the record: Michael Peterson, Sarah Markey, Siga Poy, Angelina Miller, Madeline Kruckmeyer, Jimmy Calvin, Abigail Tui, and Julia Albro Fisher. These students, along with their classmates, all of whom are about to graduate from the sixth grade at the Smith College Campus School, are demonstrating what we mean when we teach about active, engaged citizens. It was their initiative that brought the truth-telling about Columbus into our classroom. They have much to teach us about acquiring knowledge, about the determination to get the whole story out, and about having a voice in their community. In my 40th and final year at the campus school, I am tremendously appreciative of these young people who were undaunted about coming before this honorable council to tell you the rest of the story about Columbus and to seek justice and amends for the terrible mistreatment of indigenous people that his so-called discovery led to. As the African proverb I reference to teach my social justice curriculum says, until the lion tells the tale, tales of the hunt will glorify the hunter. These young people have told the lion's tale, and now we want our community to recognize the need for Indigenous Peoples Day. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Joe Galassi.
Madeline's here, so if we could add her in before.
So we'll do a Madeline after Joe.
I'm Joe Galassi. I live at 410 Spring Street in Florence. Last May, my wife and I made the decision to move to Northampton from out of state. There are many factors that led us to choose Northampton as the community we want to raise our three children in, and one of the significant factors was the town's commitment to social justice. It is evident by the existence of the Human Rights Commission, the commitment to the annual Pride Parade, the ongoing support for the community's homeless and hungry, the public acknowledgement of the Black Lives Matter movement, and most recently, the passing of the refugee resolution. This past summer, my wife and I began our new positions as educators in two local schools. We were excited to bring home our school calendars and compare vacation days. As we sat around the dinner table, we were both surprised when we saw Columbus Day listed as a school holiday and closing. This seemed contradictory to the community's commitment to social justice. As a sixth grade teacher at the Smith College Campus School, I was eager to begin a discussion with my students about this holiday and the history of the man being recognized. I was overwhelmed by the thinking of my students and their commitment to bring this issue to your table. All of us in this room understand the importance of recognizing Indigenous peoples and their histories. Renaming this holiday in our town is one step toward such recognition and can have a large impact, especially in our classrooms. Recognizing Indigenous Peoples Day will provide a wonderful opportunity for teachers to engage their children in discussions about the language change and what it means to give voice to a group whose history is often silenced. Having the resolution passed tonight will allow educators the time necessary to prepare lessons and units of study around this change. Time will be needed to gather materials, collaborate with others, and thoughtfully explore this topic prior to the start of the school year. Schools will need to change their academic calendars for next year and plan appropriate professional development if necessary to support teachers. I urge you to pass this resolution tonight. Indigenous people deserve the same respect and recognition as the other disenfranchised groups that this community works so hard to stand up for.
Thank you. Madeline, you all set? Madeline, I'm sorry, you weren't here for this, so if you could state your name and tell us where you live.
Oh. I'm Madeline Kruckmeyer and I live in Holyoke.
Thank you.
This resolution is important because if we make this happen, we will be able to have an effect on the rest of our country. If we are able to change Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day, we can help show other towns that we can make a difference. We can undo a tiny bit of racism in our country, although there will still be a whole lot of racism towards Indigenous peoples. More people will know what really happened, so they will be more aware of what is happening to them. I think this will be a very important action for our town. Even though it is a small action, it could eventually affect our entire country.
Thank you very much. Rachel Naismith, please.
Hello, I'm Rachel Naismith, 357 North Farms Road in Florence, and I was the person who worked with Elisa Klein on the wording of the resolution that that we've been talking about with regard to Indigenous Peoples Day. I feel so proud of the children who are speaking tonight. I think that the desire to be educated on who Columbus really was and on who the Native people were who were in this country, and in fact who were at the bedrock of this community, is something that not only children but community members and adults need to learn. And I feel that to be able to recognize this day, instead of being talking about Columbus Day all of the time, to be able to talk about Indigenous peoples, they're the ones who need the attention, who deserve the attention. And for many, many reasons, I really support this, and I hope that it'll get passed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bill Williams, please.
Good evening, councilors. My name is Bill Williams. I live at 11 Barrett Place in Northampton. I'm a member of the board of Broadbrook Coalition, which manages the stewardship of Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area. And I'm here tonight to comment on our application for continuing management of invasives at Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area, particularly Cook's Pasture. It's one of our prime pieces of property. It's managed as shrubland. Shrubland is becoming a scarce resource in Massachusetts, and it's excellent wildlife habitat. The proposed plan that we have is similar to our past efforts, which have been very successful, and they've been made possible by the city's previous support of through CPA grants. The specifics of our proposal will be outlined by my colleague, Dave Herships, who follows me, and my comments are gonna focus on invasive control methodology. For the past 7 years, our control program has involved a two-tier system. One is mechanical, and the other is the use of herbicides. Wherever possible, we have tried to use mechanical means, and that's involved hand pulling and digging. And also, two times during the summer, we've gone out in kayaks and canoes and hand pulled massive amounts of water chestnuts from Fitzgerald Lake. Mechanical means are not effective or impractical, we've used herbicides sparingly. The herbicides are being applied by Pollen Ecological Services using licensed personnel. In the proposed program that we will use, we use the same herbicides as in the past, Garland 3A and Garland 4, as well as Milestone. Now, these are widely used in natural areas, and they have little or no toxicity to mammals and birds. When they're used as recommended and in the rates that have been directed. The herbicide application process uses hand-pumped low-volume backpack sprayers, which can be targeted to specific plants, so there's little fallout and drift to adjacent plants. The herbicides are only applied when there's no wind and there hasn't been no rain. Also, for larger buckthorns that have been previously cut down, herbicides are applied using a sponge on the individual stumps. So the bottom line is herbicides are used sparingly in small amounts and using targeted application methods. So my take-home message before Big Ben runs out here is invasive control is an ongoing process. It's difficult to completely eliminate invasives, and therefore management for effective control requires continual monitoring and removal of new outbreaks. If funding for invasive control is not available and the program cannot continue, benefits of our past efforts will be lost as invasives take over again. Thank you.
Thank you very much. David Herships, please.
Good evening, councilors. My name is David Herships. I live at 22 Warburton Way in Northampton. I'm here tonight as my colleague Bill Williams indicated to ask your support for the $12,800 grant under the Community Preservation Act. And the Gerald Lake Conservation Area has benefited from that enormously over the last several years since the program has been in effect, which is going over 10 years now. The program, as Bill indicated, is going to call for a multi-year application starting in June, assuming the program is approved by the City Council. It calls for spending $6,100 in 2016, $3,350 in 2017, and then $3,350 again in 2018. And again, as Bill indicated, it's been a multi-year program, and it's been necessary. Invasive species, and for anybody who's looked around town, if you've been on the bike path, you've seen in past years massive infestations of Japanese knotweed. It's a town-wide effort to control these the invasives, and at Fitzgerald Lake, we're doing our own little bit. By the way, I ought to mention to you, since I see a couple of new faces here, the Broadbrook Coalition is an all-volunteer, not-for-profit, 501c3. We have a memorandum of understanding with the City Conservation Commission, which owns the land. The city owns the land at 850 acres, over 850 acres now at the Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area, which is a real gem. And we willingly do the work there. We understand the city does not have the staff or the resources to do all that work, and it's a really a labor of love. And I've been personally involved with the Broadbrook Coalition as a volunteer and now a member of the board for over 10 years. So we appreciate all the support we've gotten from the city on this. Just to reiterate what Bill said, this is the products are safe. We have a letter of support, which is in the information package that I assume you have, from Laurie Sanders, who's a well-known naturalist in town. And we just hope that you can approve this. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Catherine Morris, please.
Good evening. My name is Catherine Morris, 9 Prospect Heights, Northampton, Mass. Time to ban the use of gas leaf blowers, as hundreds of American cities have and towns have done. Why? In part because of the heavy contribution of gas-powered leaf blowers to air pollution. A single small gas-powered leaf blower creates as much air pollution as 50 full-size sedans. The exhaust from leaf blowers is much higher in nitrous oxide than from automobiles, and unlike the auto exhausts, consists in large part of a fine spray of oils and hydrocarbons, and these inhaled can cause cancer in humans and animals. Of course, there is the noise pollution problem. A typical gas-powered leaf blower will produce a noise level of 75 decibels at 50 feet and 100 decibels at close range. Often, two or more blowers are being used simultaneously at a nearby house. These levels can cause serious hearing loss, and prolonged exposure can increase the incidence of heart attacks. Isn't it time for Northampton and other Western Massachusetts communities to take action to control the annoying and damage, the annoyance and damage caused by gas leaf blowers? This is, of course, in addition to the already poor quality of air we have in this county. We're landlocked and no ocean to blow it out. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Kim Gerald.
Kim Gerald, 66 Pines Edge Drive. Ditto to what the teacher over there said. I forget your name. My third grade students and I at Jackson Street School spend a lot of time learning about Native people here in the Valley and throughout New England, historically, and also about the Native people that continue to live here. And every year around Columbus Day, we read Jane Yolen's book called Encounter. And it's the story of a Taino boy in the Caribbean, and it's from his perspective. And he encounters Columbus and his crew. And my students have observed that Columbus didn't really discover America, and that the indigenous people had lived in this so-called New World for thousands of years. They also find out that without knowing it, Columbus and all the Europeans that followed brought illnesses that decimated Native tribes. Columbus also kidnapped several Tainos, and in this story we see this happen, and brought them back to show the King and Queen of Spain. And he wrote in his journal, which we read, about what good slaves they would make. And in Hispaniola, which is Haiti and the Dominican Republic, the Tainos were enslaved and the population almost disappeared after 50 years after the arrival of the Spanish. This is not something we want to celebrate. In my third grader's words, It is important to remember this time, how life began to change in a bad way for Native Americans. If we don't tell the whole story, it's like telling only part of the truth. Columbus didn't really see Indians as real people, but we know that they are real people, and they were here first. We hope to be celebrating Indigenous Peoples Day next October. Thank you.
Thank
me and 18 other third graders.
Thank you.
One of whom is...
Chloe Comerford, Hennessy, please.
Good evening, everyone. You want to say your name? I'm Joe Comerford. I'm Chloe Comerford, Hennessy's mom. And I'm going to be up here with Chloe. Chloe wrote these words and is proud to speak them for you this evening through me.
That's fine.
My name is Chloe Comerford Hennessy.
You're not.
I am not. And I am 9 years old. I live on Federal Street in Florence, and I am a student at Jackson Street School. I think we should change Columbus Day into Indigenous Peoples Day because Columbus didn't discover this land. Native Americans discovered the land before Columbus. He brought diseases that killed many people, and he took people as slaves to show them off in other countries. Please consider changing the name to Indigenous Peoples Day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chloe, and translator. Carolyn Oppenheim, please.
I'm Carolyn Toll Oppenheim. I live at 3 Montview Avenue, and I'm here for two things. The first thing, which would be the briefest, is that I heartily endorse the change to Indigenous Peoples Day, but it's not the first time I've done it. I sit on the Human Rights Commission, and several months ago, we unanimously supported the it's an ordinance, right?
It's a resolution.
Whatever, it should be an ordinance. But anyway, I endorse it in whatever form. The other reason I'm here is I want to speak a little bit about the, because of the second reading, and this is an ordinance, on not privatizing water. I've talked to a lot of people about this, and people say, well, why do we need to do this? There's nobody barking at the door. There's no company, you know, threatening us, and the city is not imminently going to make this change. Well, as a veteran of water privatization battles in Holyoke and Lee, where my late husband, Ward Morehouse, and I used to work with citizens' action groups, I can tell you that this ordinance is a real gift to the city to prevent it happening in a scenario where the city were to fall on hard times financially. God forbid, we don't want that to happen, but imagine a situation where it just gets so expensive to run our water system, we have to upgrade, our back is to the wall, and corporations know that, and they come flocking around, trying to make sweetheart deals, whispering to the Chamber of Commerce, trying to see if there's business, I'm talking about a future city council, not this one. Maybe there's business-minded people, they can bend their ear and say, look, we have best practices, we can do it leaner, we can do it meaner. We'll have a public-private partnership with you. Well, public-private partnerships are never partnerships because the private side of the public-private partnership gets control, they control the budget. It costs, to do it as a real partnership would cost the city so much money in engineer oversight that it wouldn't even make sense to do it. But that's what happens to communities. They get backed up, they can't afford, and they get scared. And then these multinational corporations come and they get the process going before the public can get involved and really organize to look for other options and do collaborative problem solving. Am I at my minutes? This puts a brake on that process. If we were ever at a point where that horrible situation conceivably could emerge, we would have to have public forum in this city to change the ordinance. And that would give people time to organize, to explore, to see what other communities have done, and it would slow the whole thing down. Right now, in Bloomfield, Connecticut, and West Hartford, Connecticut, they are fighting Nestle's, and it's happening all over the country. So I urge you to put this in to protect our future.
Thank you very much. Claudia Lefko, please.
Claudia Lefko, 40 Valley Street in Northampton. I live in Ward 3, and I'm here to comment on the shuffle on the City Council a little bit. I was surprised to hear that that the Ward 3 councilor could run at large without giving up his seat in Ward 3. And because it means that if Ryan were to win the election in November, the upcoming election, that we would have to then have an election in our ward. So first we're having to spend $40,000 or whatever to have an at-large city election, and then we would have to have another election further on. So I'm here to suggest it's not that good of a use of the city's money to have two elections, and that perhaps either Councillor Ryan O'Donnell would agree to, on his own, to sort of resign his seat, or I think in the future, I'm asking that some policy be made so that this wouldn't happen in the future. It doesn't make sense in this time when we're hearing from people already about the how tight the budget is in the city, that we're going to spend money once for an election and then again for an election. So I'm asking, no matter what happens in this particular cycle with people quitting and moving around, that you consider in the future making a rule that would ask the person who wants to move from one location to another in the council to resign their seat. I don't understand, actually, why somebody would want to do this, because it seems there's equal access from the ward. You still have the city as your, you know, you can still speak to the whole city and represent the whole city. And there's plenty to do in Ward 3. So whatever, I'm just worried about how we're spending money, and I'm worried about a process that I don't think is a very smooth process. So I hope the City Council will consider changing it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Praveen?
Hi, my name is Irvine Sobelman. I live at 116 Laurel Park, and I'm here in support of the ordinance pertaining to water resources. There's a legal framework that I've been learning about recently known as the public trust doctrine, and it really resonates with me. I'm a firm believer that we hold in trust the air, the water, the soil, all of our shared and life-sustaining resources, that we hold them in trust for our children, our grandchildren, and future generations. And private, often multinational, investor-owned corporations are not guardians for our resources. They aren't intended to be. Their mission is profit, and short-term profit at that. So I commend the City Council, the representative body for our community, for taking this step to affirm that safe, clean, accessible, affordable water will be kept under our community's control and not open to the highest bidder. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's all I have signed up. Is there someone interested who didn't sign up who would like to speak? No? Okay. I'm going to ask the administrative assistant to call the roll, please.
Councilor Bidwell?
Here.
Councilor Carney?
Present.
Councilor Dwight?
Here.
Councilor Klein?
Here.
Councilor LaBarge?
Present.
Councilor Murphy?
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Here.
Councilor Shara?
Here.
Have a quorum, so we can convene. We have a public hearing regarding a petition from National Grid to relocate a pole on Elm Street. I would move to, actually, why don't we wait till the room clears out a little bit? But I'll accept a motion to open the hearing.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of opening the hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
We should hear from proponents first. And oh, look. Here's a proponent now. Lisa, you.
Hello. Members of the council, Lisa Jasinski with National Grid. I'm here to request that we get permission to relocate a pole on Elm Street. This is for the new entry that's going to be revamped for College Lane going into Smith College. It's really moving the pole. It's going to be at a location approximately 47 feet west of the existing, 47 feet west of the intersection of College Lane, which moves the pole about 11 feet. And it's just right now in the way of the new sidewalks that will be going in.
Are there any questions of the proponent?
I have a question.
Yeah, Lisa.
So I understand that we have on our agenda tonight, we're supposed to be considering this. And so I'm just wondering about, what is it called, the land order? Somebody help me out here.
I'm not sure what you're fishing for. A land taking?
Yeah.
It's on the agenda.
Which is related to the location that we're talking about, so I'm just...
It's the discontinuance of a portion of Elm Street.
Right. And my understanding is it's the same piece of land that we're talking about for the pole relocation. Is that not true? I mean, I just feel like I'm wondering if we have, if there's something relevant in that piece that is relevant to this, and we're kind of doing this in a backwards order.
Well, I think that, and correct me if I'm wrong, it sounds to me that there is an agreement about, there's a couple of parking spaces, I think, that's going to be taken over in this. If that doesn't take place, the poles will not be moved. I don't know if that makes a difference in this. I don't know where that stands, because that's between you folks and Smith College, the city and Smith College, I believe. And this is our work in preparation for that move. If that doesn't happen, I would say...
So the relocation is contingent upon our voting to allow this to happen. Okay, so that makes sense.
Yeah, and they're not mutually exclusive.
So. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Are there any opponents or other people wishing to speak on this at this hearing about this poll? I'd accept a motion to close the public hearing.
Second it.
All those in favor of closing the public hearing, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Second.
It's on the consent agenda for that.
Yes. Oh, it's embedded in the consent agenda. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I have an announcement relative to public hearing. The following public hearing is hereby advertised in accordance with the Charter of Northampton, Massachusetts, Article 7. Finance and Fiscal Procedures, Section 7-4, and the action on the operating budget, a public hearing. And by order of the City Council, public hearing to be held, FY 2017, I'm sorry. Yep, I was getting, it's, by order of the City Council, public hearing to be held on Thursday, June 2nd, 2016. At 7:05 in the City Council chambers located here in the Wallace J. Pulchowski Municipal Building, 212 Main Street, Northampton, Massachusetts. The City Council will consider the proposed FY 2017 budget, even though it says here on the agenda 2016, and hear all persons who wish to be heard thereon. That would be the next City Council meeting. And now we come up to recognition, 1 minute announcements. Councilor O'Donnell.
Thank you. Related to that item, the City Council will hold two budget hearings itself to speak to individual city departments, and the public is welcome to those meetings as well. The first will be Wednesday, May 25th, and that will consist of Fire Rescue Department and Central Services. And then Thursday, May 26th, which will consist of the Department of Public Works, Northampton Police Department, Forbes Library, Planning and Sustainability, Northampton Public Schools, and the Arts and Culture Department. And there may be other departments that appear as well, but they are not scheduled at this time. And so those are two hearings the City Council will be holding in advance of the formal public hearing on the budget. Oh, I'm sorry, beginning 5:30. Thank you.
Other announcements. the Memorial Day Parade, and I'm trying to find all the particular data on that. The Memorial Day Parade will be stepping off in Florence at 10:30, right?
No, 10 o'clock, sorry, 9:30.
9:30 assembly, 10 o'clock stepping off. Council LaBarge is in charge of the banner. Be leading the way, so for councilors who are participating, please assemble at 9 o'clock. For citizens, it is an excellent and honorable parade to witness, but it also has a feeling of joy, too. I commend it to you and hope you have the opportunity to go experience that. Councilor LaBarge.
How many councilors are planning on attending?
I mean, 1, 2, 3... Four.
Can I see the time again?
It's assemble at 9:30, step off at 10. Usually there's you do the double loop, and then there's a ceremony afterwards.
This is Monday?
Yes. Monday, Memorial Day. I will not be present. I will be attending my son's 30th birthday. This would be the first parade I've missed, by the way. Any other announcements? Okay. Your Honor, this is the mayor is here with the 2017 budget.
Mr. President, I was going to suggest, since there are folks who are here for some other matters, if you wanted to defer my communications till after the consent agenda, I'd be happy to yield.
What's the council's pleasure? What the mayor is suggesting, I believe, is to move up the Indigenous Peoples Day resolution up on the agenda. Is that all right with everyone?
Yes.
Just nodding consent will do. Thank you, Your Honor. Okay. Yeah, can I have a motion to change the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on that? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So, and I will read the resolution. This is in the year 2015, upon the recommendations of Councilors Elisa F. Klein.
2016, actually, it should be.
Yeah, everyone's getting off by a year today. And it's, 2016, upon the recommendation of Councilors Elisa F. Klein and Maureen T. Carney and the Northampton Human Rights Commission. This is item 16.093, and it's a resolution recognizing the second Monday of October as Indigenous Peoples Day. And whereas the City of Northampton recognizes that the Indigenous peoples of the lands that would later become known as the Americas have occupied these lands since time immemorial. And whereas the City of Northampton recognizes that Northampton is built upon the ancestral homelands and villages of the Indigenous peoples of this region, without whom the building of the city would not have been possible, to wit, from the Mohegan tribe to the Nipmucks and the Pequots, and from the Mohegan tribe and the
Pecumtucks.
Who established the village of Norwalk or Nonotuck, upon which much of present-day Northampton is situated. And whereas the City of Northampton wishes to uplift the Indigenous roots in the history of and contributions to our city and this country. And whereas the City of Northampton is committed to respecting and protecting the full range of human rights as set forth in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and numerous other international human rights treaties. And whereas the City of Northampton, in an effort to promote truth, healing, reconciliation, redress, and justice, acknowledges the ongoing trauma and historical harms, acts of genocide, and violations of the human rights of Native American, Alaskan Native, and other American Indigenous peoples. Excuse me. And whereas the City of Northampton has a responsibility to oppose the systemic racism towards Indigenous people in the United States, which perpetuates their income, health, educational, and social inequality. And whereas, despite the fact that the federal government guaranteed the health, safety, and welfare of tribal nations in exchange for over 450 million acres of tribal land, American Indian and Alaskan Native citizens experience higher disease rates, lower life expectancy rates, higher dropout rates, and higher poverty rates than any other racial or ethnic group in the country. And whereas the median income of American Indian and Alaskan Native households is 70% of the median income of all U.S. households, and 28.4% of American Indians and Alaska Natives live in poverty compared to 15.3% Americans as a whole. And whereas American Indians and Alaska Natives have a life expectancy that is 4.2 years less than all other races in the United States and die at higher rates than other Americans from many diseases and harms, including chronic liver disease, cirrhosis, diabetes, assault, and homicide, and intentional self-harm and suicide. And whereas data from the National Center for Education Statistics show that on average, less than 50% of American Indian and Alaskan Native students graduate from high school. And whereas the City of Northampton understands that in order to help close the equity gap, government entities, organizations, and other public institutions should change their policies and practices to better reflect and significantly improve the experiences and outcomes of the American Indian people. And whereas the idea of Indigenous Peoples Day was first proposed in 1977 by a delegation of Native Nations to the United Nations-sponsored International Conference on Discrimination Against Indigenous Populations in the Americas. And whereas in 1990, representatives from 120 Indigenous nations at the First Continental Conference on 500 years of Indian resistance unanimously passed a resolution to transform Columbus Day into an occasion to strengthen the process of continental unity and struggle towards liberation, and thereby use the occasion to reveal a more accurate historical record. And whereas the United States federal government, the state of Massachusetts, and the city of Northampton recognized Columbus Day on the second Monday of October in accordance with the federal holiday established in 1937. Now therefore be it resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts, one, hereby proclaims that the second Monday in October each year will be known as Indigenous Peoples Day, and two, celebrates and honors the foundational contributions of Indigenous peoples to the history of our city, the state of Massachusetts, and our country. And three, encourages the city schools and other institutions to use Indigenous Peoples Day as a point from which to, throughout the year, reflect upon and learn upon the historical abuses and continuing struggles of Indigenous nations, and to celebrate the magnificent foundations of the Indigenous peoples of this land upon which our city, state, and country were built. And four, encourages businesses and organizations in Northampton to recognize Indigenous Peoples Day. And five, shall continue to promote racial, economic, educational, health, and social equity and justice for all people, and oppose discrimination towards Indigenous peoples as it is perpetuated through the inequities in income, health, and education. And I'll read the note here. This resolution was developed thanks to Northampton resident Rachel Naismith, who initiated the project and gathered data for inclusion in the resolution, and thanks as well to the Smith Campus sixth grade class of Tom Weiner and Joe Galassi for their December 17, 2015, they got that date right, presentation of the City Council on Columbus and the need for an Indigenous Peoples Day in Northampton. I'll accept a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Would the sponsors like to speak to this, please?
Yep, I would. Got to pull it up. So in 1990, the South Dakota legislature passed a state holiday called Native American Day, and it's celebrated annually. In 1992, Berkeley, California was the first city to formally recognize an Indigenous Peoples Day. Since then, we have no fewer than 20 other cities across the United States that have declared the second Monday of October Indigenous Peoples Day. Most recently, in fact, just yesterday, Amherst, at its town meeting, overwhelmingly approved a resolution that was written by Amherst Regional Middle School students to replace Columbus Day with Indigenous Peoples Day. I really loved the quote in the Daily Hampshire Gazette from one of the middle schoolers who wrote the legislation. He said, "We believe when we are celebrating Columbus, we believe we are celebrating genocide." This is a bold and precocious statement that echoes that of Lonnie Hancock, who was the mayor of Berkeley in 1992, when that city was the first one to declare Indigenous Peoples Day in that city. She said, "Columbus Day celebrations have been Eurocentric and have ignored the brutal realities of the colonization of Indigenous peoples. We owe it to the children of Northampton and our adults as well that they understand that It was and is this country's legal, fiduciary, and moral responsibility to protect and ensure the well-being of Native tribes. As the resolution notes, the federal government guaranteed the health, safety, and welfare of tribal nations in exchange for over 450 million acres of tribal land that were given to, to the federal government. Yet throughout the last several centuries, we've seen that the indigenous peoples of this country have, in fact, experienced all the signs of governmental and societal neglect and racism, such as higher disease rates, lower life expectancy rates, all of the things that are in the resolution. What's most important about a resolution like this and the effect that we wanted to have in our city is that we don't want to just make this one day, that an Indigenous People's Day, the only day of the year during which we recognize the centrality and the importance of Indigenous peoples to our current lives and to our city. It's my hope that with the passage of this resolution, Northampton will recognize and work harder to achieve equity, fairness, and social justice for all people, and that our schools will not teach a Eurocentric curriculum, history, analysis of our city, the region, the state, and the country, but rather a history that goes back and documents our true roots, the people who inhabited this region and all of North America since way before Columbus arrived, and way before he set in motion centuries of near genocide of the indigenous peoples who lived here. I hope that our school committee will pick up this charge to recognize an Indigenous Peoples Day on the second Monday in October to make clear the expectation that a sound education in this city includes the recognition of ways in which our country has invisibilized Native peoples and perpetuated their poverty, their ill health, subpar educational resources, and other ills. I'd like to see these realities linked to other racisms in our city, with a focus on continuing to address them vigorously, transparently, and with true commitment. I want to thank my fellow counselor, Councilor Carney, the Northampton Human Rights Commission, for co-sponsoring this resolution with me. And I really want to, although it's written into the resolution, I want to thank the children of the Smith Campus School, Tom Wiener and Joe Galassi, their teachers, for coming to talk to us last December. And everyone who came to speak tonight in favor of this resolution. And mostly I want to thank Rachel Naismith, who is a Ward 7 resident. She came to me initiating this. I had been thinking about it too, and it was just a perfect synchronicity of kind of timing and interest. We got together and worked together to kind of really do the research and create the wording, and I'm just very grateful that Rachel really pushed that to happen. So I really hope that my fellow counselors will see this as a righteous piece of work that we need to pass here in City Council. Thank you.
Councilor Carney.
Thank you. I want to thank my fellow counselor, Elisa Klein, for inviting me to co-sponsor this. I see this as a really important piece of legislation, this resolution. I want to thank the people that Councilor Klein mentioned, especially Rachel Naismith, for all of the diligent work writing this, and for the teachers that spoke tonight, Tom Wiener and Joe Galassi, and for the students from the Smith Campus School and from the Jackson Street School that spoke. I just want to also point out what some of the other teachers, having been a teacher for nearly 10 years in the Northampton Public Schools, how important it is to be able to have the time to do some research and do some lesson plans around this. And I think that, you know, it's something that will be important if we pass this tonight, not only for the students across all of Northampton, but also for Northampton residents. I mean, when I think it's been at least 30 years now since TD Bank previously, Springfield Savings previously, the Naugatuck Savings Bank in the city of Northampton was probably one of the only references to that village of Naugatuck or Naugatuck that we had in the city. And I think it's a great opportunity for those of us who live here to really educate ourselves further on, you know, the Naugatuck people that inhabited this city of Northampton long before the Europeans who came here and created it in the 1600s as a city. So Again, I just want to thank everyone involved and for the opportunity to be able to co-sponsor this tonight. Thank you.
Anyone else? It's worth noting that actually, technically, Northampton does not recognize Columbus Day insofar as that it is a municipal holiday as noted, mandated by the state, but that there is no Columbus Day celebration for that matter. But I think it's more appropriate to actually not only to not just ignore it, but to actually emphasize the history that actually led to the establishment of that holiday in this country so that everyone understands the context. The Indigenous Peoples Day is an appropriate honor. We actually, by resolution, we don't change a state holiday, so I want everyone to understand that, and that we don't prescribe work vacations or holidays. But as a day, and beyond a day, as Councilor Klein and Councilor Carney noted, and as the resolution says, it's just to not just stay in that moment, but to think beyond that moment and to consider what it is that we enjoy here actually came at a price, a significant price, and a price that has never been properly honored or recognized. So. It's my intent to support this initiative. So, any other discussion? Okay, this is a resolution. It's usually a voice vote, but I'm going to ask for a roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
It passes in first reading. We will revisit this the next city council meeting. It is by our rules, we vote on each item twice just to make sure we got it right the first time. So it will not become a fully recognized resolution until the next council meeting, pending that vote. So thanks again to everyone who's participating in this a meaningful discussion. I appreciate it very much. Now, so we'll move back up to the sexy part of the agenda, which is budget.
Resolution.
Oh, what? No, the mayor, didn't we defer the mayor?
Oh, we have another resolution.
Yeah, but that, we're gonna bump the, I thought we were just bumping the one.
Yeah.
Because we didn't have anyone waiting for on that issue, so. So the mayor is presenting his budget, which, by the way, is kind of a significant thing to discuss if folks want to stay and pay attention. But I understand why you might want to leave. But. Your Honor.
Thank you. Good evening, councilors. Yeah, tonight I was planning to deliver my budget message to the city council. I know you were delivered a copy of the FY 2017 budget on Tuesday. We delivered it to the city council and to the city clerk pursuant to the charter. And I wanted to take the opportunity to just read my budget message to you and obviously to the public. Just scroll this. Okay. To the honorable members of the city council. I submit for your consideration and approval my proposed $106,227,661 fiscal year 2017 budget for the City of Northampton in accordance with Article 7, Section 7-3 of our Charter. The budget is comprised of an $89,946,013 general fund for our city departments and schools, which represents a 1.7% increase from the current year budget. It also includes our four separate enterprise fund budgets for water, $7,463,768, sewer, $6,271,872, solid waste, $588,450, and stormwater, $1,957,558. Taken as a whole, this budget proposal represents a 2.5% increase over the current FY 2016 city budget expiring on June 30th, 2016. In addition to funding city services in our two school districts, this budget invests $10.4 million in technology, equipment, facilities, and infrastructure, as outlined in the capital improvement section of the budget. Included among the 46 capital projects funded are critical upgrades to our public safety radio and emergency dispatch communication systems, vehicle replacements for police, fire, rescue, and public works, and needed building repairs and energy management and security system improvements at our schools. We will also invest $2.5 million to replace aging water, sewer, and storm lines across our city and begin the phased design and construction of a critical multi-million dollar renovations to our 40-year-old wastewater treatment facility and sewer pump stations. This budget also continues our aggressive citywide street resurfacing program begun 2 years ago, leveraging state Chapter 90 paving funds with $500,000 in local dollars as part of a projected five-year $3.25 million infusion of Northampton tax dollars into our aging streets and sidewalks. This FY 2017 budget holds special significance because it was originally projected as the final year of the multi-year fiscal stability plan we implemented 3 years ago in the face of a $1.4 million budget gap and looming cuts to staff and services. We stabilized Northampton's finances by using a portion of new tax revenues from a $2.5 million general override to close the FY 2014 funding gap while securing the balance in a new fiscal stability fund. Our original plan laid out a reasonable growth course for revenues and expenditures, allowing us to maintain level city and school services in FY 2014, FY 2015, and FY 2016 before drawing down the fiscal stability fund to supplement a level service FY 2017 budget. That first plan projected that after 4 years, we would be basically back where we started, facing another revenue shortfall and the prospects of service cuts or another override entering the FY 2018 budget year on July 1st, 2017. In presenting our multi-year plan, I promised taxpayers we would update it annually and work hard every day in between to budget and spend wisely, seek cost savings and efficiencies, and pursue new revenues and increase state aid with a goal of stretching the new override revenues farther and extending our fiscal stability. 3 years later, as I submit this actual FY 2017 budget, I'm proud to say that we have delivered on those promises. The updated general fund fiscal stability plan attached to this budget message shows current revenue and expenditure projections can continue to sustain our city and school services for three additional years beyond the proposed FY 2017 budget through FY 2020. One key to our success in extending the plan has been fiscal discipline. While we've strived over the last 3 years to provide the resources and capital equipment our staff and departments need to deliver important municipal and school services, we have also been careful to not overextend and stay within our projected fiscal targets under the multi-year budget plan. We've also focused on delivering services more cost-efficiently, taking advantage of opportunities to rethink organizational structures when retirements or other staffing changes have occurred. One example of this approach is our new Office of the Treasurer-Collector, included in this FY 2017 budget. Following the retirement of our longtime city collector last summer, I issued an administrative order approved by this council that merged the Office of the Collector and the Office of the Treasurer under the leadership of a newly appointed combined Treasurer-Collector, Christine Bissell. The merger and subsequent reorganization of these previously separate offices has improved efficiency and customer service and resulted in an overall savings to the city in both operational and staffing costs of $77,531. Another example of our efforts to find savings for this year's budget is found in the debt service section. Last December, the city undertook a major refinancing of capital debt issues from 2002, 2004, and 2007, totaling $9.9 million. Refinancing our debt at a lower interest rate saved the city $43,082 in interest costs in this budget, the FY 2017 budget, and will save us a total of $670,478 over the next 11 years. I'm grateful to the City Council for its collaboration and support in implementing these and other important cost-saving measures. Another major key to our success in extending the fiscal stability plan has been new growth. Northampton has experienced high levels of both residential and commercial construction over the last few years, exceeding our conservative projections. New growth was $938,241 in FY 2016, the highest it has been in the last decade. When we built our multi-year budget projections 3 years ago, new growth had been averaging just under $485,000 a year for the previous 4 years. This steady upswing in economic activity has expanded our tax base, providing additional revenues in the form of new growth to support municipal and school costs. As mayor, I'm committed to ensuring that this positive economic growth trend continues, particularly for our downtown. I'm proud, for example, of the city's role in helping create the new Downtown Northampton Association, or DNA, and the commitment of resources we are making to ensure its success. Part of that commitment is embedded in this FY 2017 budget, with the formalization of a new central services parking maintenance position dedicated to daily cleaning and maintenance activities in the central business district. This budget also contains capital funding for a two-phase effort to improve our downtown and parking signage, a key recommendation of the downtown parking study. In previous budget messages, I have focused on the need for increased state support to lessen our increased reliance on property taxes to fund local government. The loss of state aid and concurrent increases in state charges to Northampton for charter school and school choice students remains one of the largest single factors affecting our ability to fund critical local services. Governor Baker's proposed FY 2017 state budget increases unrestricted local aid to cities and towns by 4.3%, which is a $174,229 increase for Northampton, but offers little in the way of increased education funding for minimum aid districts like ours or addressing the damaging fiscal impacts of charter schools. Northampton will spend almost $2.5 million in outgoing charter school tuition based on a projected Northampton charter school enrollment of 202 students. This is more funding than we currently allocate to any of our four elementary schools, which each serve between 230 and 330 students and have annual budgets of about $1.7 million. Overall net state aid to Northampton would actually decrease 0.8% under the governor's budget. So I'm hopeful at the time of this writing that House and Senate plans to increase minimum Chapter 70 education funding will prevail in the final state budget, so we can appropriate these additional resources to our schools in July. While continuing to advocate for increased state aid, we have also sought out other forms of new local revenue, including implementing the Northampton Payment in Lieu of Taxes, or pilot program, I introduced in last year's budget message. We currently have multiple requests pending for voluntary payments from our 10 largest private tax-exempt property owners in recognition of the municipal services they receive from the city. And our plan is to use any pilot funds received to supplement next year's capital improvement budget. Last week, I concluded negotiations with New England Treatment Access, or NETA, the operators of the medical marijuana dispensary located on Conn Street, on a host community agreement that provides $100,000 to the City of Northampton, as reflected in this FY 2017 budget. The new agreement features ongoing annual host payments that increase each year based on a percentage of the dispensary's gross revenues. I want to personally thank NETA officials for working with the city to reach this important agreement and appreciate their ongoing commitment, collaboration, and community involvement. While there is much positive news to report in submitting this year's city budget, I must conclude with a note of caution. Prudent multi-year budget planning has allowed us to maintain our city and school services in FY 2017, and with the help of the override revenues we have kept in reserve, we can likely sustain that stability through the end of FY 2020. If you review our updated general fund fiscal stability plan, however, you will note that if no significant changes in our funding structures occur before FY 2021, we will be back to where we started in 2013, facing significant deficits and the difficult choice between deep cuts or another override. It remains my central focus as mayor to forestall that scenario, and I appreciate the City Council's collaboration and support in that effort. In closing, I want to thank our city department heads and school superintendents for their work in contributing to the creation of this FY 2017 city budget. A major debt of gratitude is also owed to our incredible finance director, Susan Wright. This document is a testament to her diligent work throughout the year, overseeing the city's finances. Thank you as well to my chief of staff, Lynn Simmons, executive assistant, Cindy Murphy, and our newest team member, mayoral assistant, Bridget Rodriguez, for their important help and support throughout the budget process. I look forward to working with the City Council over the next several weeks to answer any questions about this budget or to provide additional information it may need. Copies of budget documents are available for residents to review at our two libraries and at City Hall, as well as electronically on the city's website. Respectfully submitted, Mayor David Narkowitz.
Thank you. Is there anything you want to add to that now, Your Honor?
No, there's no other communications. I know you've already announced the budget hearing, the actual public hearing that'll be in June, and then I know you have the budget hearings coming up next week, so I'm looking forward to those.
And we'll see you there for sure.
Okay.
Yes. Okay, so moving down the agenda, we come up to the other resolution. This is item 16.077, a resolution to affirm the city's non-discrimination policy and in support of equality of access in public spaces. This is second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Further discussion on this? For folks who are in attendance, this is... this actually was a resolution, excuse me, that we discussed at the last council meeting. I actually didn't make a lot of waves, just kind of a surprise, but it was to frame it, it was in response to the national discussion. And then, and now since our first vote, the state approval of recognizing transgender rights as well. I think, while we have this point of comment, I think the sponsor might want to speak to this a little bit.
Just very briefly, thank you. It was the state Senate acted, but I think the entire legislature still has to finish the job. So it's important for cities and towns to weigh in on this and express our opinion.
And I think this has been a national conversation, an appropriate national conversation, a critical national conversation. And in fact, actually, the federal government has now responded to North Carolina's reactionary response to Charlotte's ordinance. It was not too dissimilar to this one. And when the state decided that they were going to make regressive law and a discriminatory law, which the federal government is challenging right now. So, that said, all those in favor? Oh, I'm sorry.
I just had a question.
Sure.
Does the state legislation adequately address the carve out that was in the legislation? Do we think it does the job?
Yep, that's exactly its purpose. In 2012, the state of Massachusetts enacted provisions to protect against discrimination on the basis of gender identity in the traditional areas of housing and employment and education and so on, but it did leave the carve out. And in fact, I think we were the only state that passed protections for gender identity that had that carve out. So. That's exactly right, Councilor. This is closing an important civil rights loophole. And actually, I'm proud that Northampton is doing this, and I'm proud that there's, unanimous agreement that this is something to take action on and a principle that we all believe in. So.
Okay. Any other comments or thoughts? This is second reading, so all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed or any abstentions? That passes in second. Now comes the time that we recess and go into finance.
I think we were going to go into city services.
Oh, I'm sorry. I take that back. For folks attending, you get three meetings contained in one. So we're Yeah, thanks. This is a recess for the City Council Committee on City Services.
Okay, and because our thing is turned towards the other, I'll crank my neck over this way. Okay, I will ask the administrative assistant to call the roll, please, of the City Services Committee.
Councilor Bidwell?
Here.
Councilor Carney?
Present.
Councilor LaBarge?
Present.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Here.
Okay, and I guess I'll ask if there's any public comment before the Committee on City Services. Okay, hearing none. Do we have minutes then that I would ask if there's a member who would offer a motion to approve?
Move to approve.
Motion to approve.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None? No abstentions? Okay, that motion passes. And what we have referred to us tonight is the appointment of the DPW director, Donna LaScalia, who was referred to the committee on May 5th. And I will point out to those in the audience that ordinarily we take this matter up in our regularly scheduled meeting. What we decided to do was to hold our normally scheduled meeting. This is a special meeting in order to meet the deadlines of the charter. And so ordinarily if there's an appointment that comes to the City Council, we have a certain window of time to report back. And so by having the meeting tonight, we'll be able to do that and also offer the opportunity for other councilors to weigh in. So just so folks understand why we're doing this. I guess I will allow the mayor to introduce to us Ms. LaScalia.
Good evening, councilors. It is my great pleasure tonight to present to you the appointee for the new Director of Public Works for the City of Northampton, Donna LaScalia. Ms. LaScalia is a former superintendent and operations supervisor for Vermont's largest electric utility, Green Mountain Power, formerly Central Vermont Public Service, where she oversaw daily operations in the Brattleboro and Wilmington districts with over 1,500 line miles of infrastructure and 8 power substations serving 25,000 customers. Her responsibilities included oversight of all regular and 24/7 emergency utility work, management of district personnel and budgets, planning and construction of capital projects, warehouse logistics and fleet management, training and safety and customer service. Prior to her work at Green Mountain Power, Ms. LaScalia was Director of Facilities Management at the World Learning SIT Graduate Institute, an international college located in Brattleboro, Vermont, with 30 buildings on a 200-acre campus. There, she led all aspects of daily facility operations, including supervision of maintenance and custodial staff, budgeting and purchasing, capital planning and construction, snow removal, field and grounds care, environmental and code compliance, and vehicle equipment and materials management. Additionally, Ms. LaScalia oversaw the operation of the college's private water and sewer utility infrastructure, planned its upgrade and expansion, and created a multi-year master plan to address deferred maintenance. Ms. LaScalia earned a bachelor's degree in economics from Boston College. She's also a licensed master electrician, having worked for the Boston Electrical Workers Union, IBEW Local 103, after college, on industrial and commercial electrical installations, including at the Boston Convention Center, South Station, Harvard University, and Quincy Market. Ms. LaScalia also holds a commercial driver's license. Actually, we discovered it's a CDLA, and there's only two of them. Two people that hold them at the DPW, and she's one of them. Donna LaScalia brings diverse experience in the utility, facility, and construction fields, a broad and adaptable skill set managing people, operations, and infrastructure, and a track record of fostering teamwork and organizational excellence. I am excited that she would be joining the City of Northampton, and I am confident that she will make an outstanding director for the dedicated and hardworking men and women of the Department of Public Works. So it's my great pleasure to introduce to you Donna LaScalia.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And it's very nice to meet you. Thank you. I guess what I'll do at this point is I'll open it up to members of the committee who may have some questions first, or maybe I'll first give an opportunity to Ms. LaScalia to have any opening remarks. Then I'd like to ask members of the committee if they have any questions, and then ask other members of the council as well. So would you like to address the council?
Yes. Thank you and good evening. Thank you, Mayor and members of the council. Over the past almost 3 weeks, I received a very warm welcome from the city, and for that I'm very grateful. I've also spent time becoming familiar with the daily operations of the DPW and familiarizing myself with some of the current projects and projects in various stages of development, and most importantly, meeting the staff of the DPW, who even after such a short time, I can confidently say, are among the most skilled, dedicated, and hardworking men and women who I have had the privilege of working with. It is my intention to lead the department in a way that continues the long tradition of exceptional service to the city and to look for ways to improve upon that if possible. And I would like to reiterate my commitment to open communication, complete availability to all stakeholders, and note that I am completely committed and vested in the long-term success of the operations of Public Works. I am honored to be here as the director, and I thank you all.
Thank you. And I know that, and I can speak for all of my colleagues here on the council, that having a direct line of communications with the DPW chief has always been a really important part of that's made my job a lot easier in terms of dealing with constituents and specific pothole problems as well as anything else. So thank you for making that offer of direct communication. I guess I'll open it up and ask first if members of the committee have some specific questions they'd like to ask. And it looks like Councilor LaBarge.
Hi, and welcome.
Thank you.
I have gone through your professional experience, Donna. On one of them, which I had a little bit of concerns, which was the field design work for new customer and capital installations, including mapping, surveying, in coordination with telephone company and third party attaches. I want to know about the part of the surveying. Tell me what you've done with the surveying part of it, because you are not an engineer, you do not have a license,
that
correct?
That is correct.
So explain to me about the surveying part that you have on here.
Sure. So when you are creating a new power line, there's a specific type of construction that is used on each pole depending upon what the angle of the pole is. So for example, if you're making a 90 degree angle, there's a particular standard for constructing that pole. So the surveying includes the placement of the pole and then the measuring of those angles between poles to determine what the type of construction is. And of course it varies if it's three-phase construction or single-phase construction. So what I'm doing is measuring the angles that are created by the placement of the poles as they go down the side of the road, and then determining how it's going to be constructed per the spec book. And then that has an effect on the third-party attachees, how they're going to construct their facilities on our pole.
Okay, with the city and our departments, with the engineers that we have, when we have city versus private property, they're licensed engineers, okay? What would you do with that circumstance? You would have to work with the engineers in the department, correct?
That is correct.
Correct. So you would work under their license, correct? Surveying, because you cannot go out, you cannot stamp any type of plans. They do.
That is correct.
Correct?
That is correct.
Okay. I wanted just to get that clarified, because I did have concerns about it, because my husband is an engineer, and he questioned that.
Yes.
Okay. I want to say, looking at your resume, it's excellent. Okay. I hear and feel, and I've talked with people, that some of the other cities are not having engineers running a Department of Public Works. And I think that's great. I think we have 5 to 7 really good engineers in our city, and other cities are doing that. Also, they're bringing in somebody with experience on management, on budgeting, okay? That's crucial to me, of who is actually the department head in running that facility. Because we already know we got the engineers. And I am looking at somebody who's got a head on the shoulder of the budget, how to handle the budget, the employees, correct? Also, the transparency with the residents on our wards is extremely valuable. And I have to agree with the counselor, Maureen Carney, about total communication. Because you'll see it on my ward, how valuable it is for them to be able to sit down with the director and be able to talk with them. You might not agree with them, but in due respect, that transparency is so valuable. So I'm going to support you. I think your resume is excellent. I like it because of how you have run big facilities, even though you're not an engineer. It's time for a change, and I am going to vote for you 100%.
Thank you. Thank you for your important questions, Councillor.
Pardon?
Thank you for your important questions.
Thank you.
And Councillor O'Donnell?
Thank you. Thank you for taking the time to come tonight. And it's a pleasure to have a nominee for this important position that does have such great qualifications. So thank you. I wanted to ask you maybe an open-ended question, because I don't have specific engineering questions to ask you myself, but I wonder if you could talk about institutions and how institutions, in your experience, that you've been involved with, change, and how you've been involved in making changes. And I don't mean to suggest that there needs to be specific or great changes in the Northampton Department of Public Works, but I know that if there's one thing you can depend on, it's that institutions do change. And you will be the head of a very significant department with many employees and with great responsibilities across the city, as you know. And how do you handle that? How do you lead it? How do you change it with all those complex interacting pieces?
I think that it is a it is said that the only constant is change. I just went through a merger with Central Vermont Public Service and Green Mountain Power. That you had two long-standing Vermont utilities with quite a few employees between them who came together as one company. And when dealing with that level of change, the biggest and most important piece is communication from leadership. And that is 95% of it. When people feel that mysterious decisions are being made or that their leaders are not communicating in an open way with them, it creates an environment where there becomes sort of suspicion and distrust. So in my experience, honesty and communication with people is the way to affect the most positive change, and also to get the buy-in necessary to make the changes by sort of communicating from the ground up and asking people what their opinions are and really hearing them when they speak. The people who do the work are the ones who understand the operations. Mm-hmm. They're the ones who have the experience and the knowledge, and it's up to us as leaders to recognize that and then take it and make good decisions with that.
Thank you. I really appreciate hearing that. Thank you.
Thank you. And Councilor Bidwell?
Yes, well, I'll extend my welcome as well to Northampton, and as well as my, I'm impressed too with your resume and your technical background, and far be it from me to comment on that. I too had a question more about communications, but sort of external public communications. It's been my experience with public works departments, not necessarily Northampton, but that brilliant engineers and technical people are sometimes not at their best when they're explaining infrastructure issues and engineering concepts to the public and to political bodies who need to be bought into the process. So I was just wondering if you could say a little bit about your experience and comfort level in translating engineering and infrastructure speak to the public to build support for your case.
This is something I learned very quickly in my time at Green Mountain Power, so interfacing with the electrical engineers for the construction of the lines that we spoke of earlier. And also this goes back to the point of the people who do the work understand it. So my job is to collect information from all parties involved. So that's the engineers, the people who actually do the work, and then put that together in a way that I can understand it so that I can explain it to others who can then understand it. So I'm synthesizing information, basically, for lack of a better word, and then explaining it in a way that the audience can hear, and my message will be tailored to whatever audience I'm speaking to. It's something that I dealt with quite a bit with the utility, just in terms of public outreach for projects and trying to explain the need for sort of relocations or technical jobs that needed to happen that weren't necessarily the most supported projects.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Councilor Dwight?
Actually, that was partially my question as well. I mean, obviously, there's, you know, difference between responding when working for a private agency, you're principally accountable to a smaller concentrated group, but in this case, of course, now you have to wear two hats, maybe three. And as I've often said, the DPW is the unheralded and unlauded agency in the city that only shows up with orange lights, without blue lights or red lights. But the fact is that I think to Councilor Carney's point, we have more critical, as councilors, have a more critical need of communications with this department in particular, because it is that level of service that's usually expected. If there's a police call, we don't have a constituent call us up and say there's a problem at my house. They call the police directly through dispatch. And in this instance, of course, it's while being somewhat of a less obvious critical agency, the fact is that it requires more outreach ability and an ability, you said, synthesize the more complicated things to explain them, and you have to be partly a politician and have to sometimes explain the process of competing interests and ultimately, when you make these critical decisions, I'm sure you're aware of that walking into it. You wouldn't have applied for the job. So, I was wondering if to the extent your previous experience has put you in a situation where you do have competing interests, that how you navigate something like that, or how you have navigated something like that.
I always say that folks typically don't pay attention to the utility until the lights go out, and then the lights go out and folks pay attention to the utility. So in my experience, there are competing priorities when something like that happens, and the single most important thing that I did was to balance the needs of all parties involved and then communicate effectively. It all goes back to communication. So there are many times when I made decisions at the height of a storm, if you will, that weren't necessarily popular with one group of people, but was popular with another group of people. And what I did was try to build consensus in as quickly a way as possible and communicate that decision as effectively as I could to everybody who needed to hear it, and we move through it.
Good on you, and I'm presuming here, but I'm going to say the best of luck to you.
Councilor Shiara.
I just want to say welcome. I know it's never easy to step into this kind of leadership position. And I just want to acknowledge that you are stepping into it at a particularly tough and sad time for the department after the leaving and then passing of Ned Huntley and also losing one of our engineers, Jim Morales. So thank you so much. We're so grateful you're here. Any way we can offer support, please let us know. And for better or for worse, you'll get to know us pretty well. So welcome.
Thank you. And I would like to say about that I have tremendous respect for those who have come before me. And I think it's important to remember their contributions. And for that, I'm grateful that the department is where it is because of what they have done. Thank
you. Yes, Councilor Klein.
I also want to add my welcome. Thank you. Thank you for being here. I'm excited. I have appreciated your answers tonight. Did you know you're going to have to be interviewed yet another time? So I wanted to ask about your experience with green infrastructure. We have the solar array going up on the landfill, a lot of excitement around reuse, all kind of under the DPW's aegises. And I'm just wondering about things like pesticide reduction and just other green infrastructure pieces, what your experience is, what knowledge you bring, what passion around it you might bring to the city.
The SIT Graduate Institute is well known for its green initiatives. And during my tenure there, we implemented a lot of recycling programs, composting programs. All the food material was trucked to our processing facility and then returned to the campus as soil for the community garden. The campus, as we constructed new pieces to buildings or new buildings, we engaged in building practices that were environmentally friendly. The campus was rather old, built in the 50s, so as we upgraded, we made sure to be cognizant of the fact that we were sort of starting from scratch. In terms of solar arrays, that was something that I spent a lot of time working on at Green Mountain Power. I do have some experience managing those projects. And there was a fairly large solar array that went in at exit 2 off 91, once, or exit 3 rather, off 91, once you're in Vermont, the Winstanley Solar Site, that's one of the largest in Vermont, that was built by my line crew while I was still there. So massive, massive facility.
And what about the use of herbicides and pesticides and that kind of thing? And how have you kind of looked into that? Do you have a sense of moving in a direction of less pesticide use, that kind of thing?
I have a peripheral awareness because of the forestry management program with Green Mountain Power. So a lot of times people think utilities and trees are sort of mutually exclusive. I was not in charge of the forestry program. However, I was privy to the facets of it where there was sort of a targeted removal of sort of problem areas instead of kind of a mass dose of herbicide application that would wipe everything out. So sort of GMP was very good at having sort of a systematic approach to maintenance trimming and then removals of sort of problem trees and vegetation instead of, you know, wiping out the entire corridor.
Any other questions? Okay, I guess I'll take some time now to, as I was coming in the door, Ms. LaScalia and I share an affiliation. We're both IBEW electricians trained in the union. And also, you know, what point out to my colleagues that it's still a field in the year 2016. The construction field is still only has 2% women and a 98% male-dominated, you know, industry.
And maybe you could talk a little bit about your time in the rank and file. I know you talked a lot, we heard a bit about your years in the Boston construction boom, but maybe just a bit, we heard a lot about your management experience. Maybe you could just share a little bit about how those other experiences have balanced out and can give you some help as you go into this new role.
Sure, I started as a first year apprentice at the new Boston Convention Center when they broke ground down there. For the first 6 months of my apprenticeship, I carried 4-inch PVC through the mud from one end of that convention center to the other end. And when I was done with that, I vacuumed sludge out of the floor boxes. And there were over 1,000 of them. Of course, it's built, there's quite a bit of fill and water in that area. And it was a difficult job, to say the least. You know, as I worked my way up through and finished my apprenticeship out and became a master electrician, I have a great appreciation for the people who actually do the work because I've done it. And I've worked outside when it's below zero, and I've worked outside when it's 100 degrees, and I've carried the pipe and climbed the ladders and climbed the tower cranes. And having an appreciation for that sort of operation makes you, or gives you, a different perspective as a manager, because I've actually done the work. So I understand sort of the challenges that you can't necessarily quantify on a piece of paper. They're a little more abstract, but I get it. So my biggest takeaway from that experience is perspective. And I think it makes me a better manager.
I agree. Thank you. Yeah?
I'm wondering if the we have in the mm-hmm. chamber today, we have the emeritus DPW director who was interested in speaking to this nomination. George Andrikides is here, and I was wondering if it'd be appropriate to recognize him. He did want to speak.
Certainly, Mr. Andrikides, would you like to say a few words?
He traveled all this way.
Please.
Thank you. The last time I was here was approximately 10 years ago, and I was looking for money.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure whether I got any, but maybe Councillor LaBarge would remember, because he was here. On a more serious note, Donna was very gracious to meet with me after her appointment when I went to welcome her to the DPW. We had a short conversation, and I believe that she is going to move forward successfully. I know that she realizes she has tremendous challenges in front of her for reasons that were mentioned here. The word communication was mentioned very often during this meeting, but only one person spoke about support. I can tell you for a fact that without support, she's going to have an almost impossible task. Not only support from the residents, the DPW itself, but also the city council and the mayor. And I hope that you are going to give her the support, because it is good for the DPW, and it's good for the city, and it's good for her. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for making the trip. Okay, if there are no other questions from the councilors, I guess I will ask if there is a motion.
Make a motion.
Okay, I've heard a motion for a positive recommendation to the full council and a second.
Yep.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So that passes unanimously. And on our, I will ask if there's any other business to come before this committee. Hearing none, I'll ask if there's a motion. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Seconded.
And seconded. Okay, meeting is adjourned. Thank you. Thank you for coming before us tonight.
So we come out of recess. I know this is confusing for people who are watching at home. You just watched another meeting. That was the second meeting. We're back into the regular body. And the next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. Contained in the consent agenda is the approval of minutes of May 5th, 2016, the city council meeting. Also, to an approval of 16.059. This is a petition from National Grid to relocate a pole on Elm Street, to which you witnessed the scintillating hearing. And then 16.080, this is to approve petitions for secondhand dealers' licenses for Back Alley Antiques and Collectibles located at 238 Bridge Street, Ryan's Jewelers located at 14 Strong Avenue, and Modern Myths Incorporated located at 34 Bridge Street. Also, this is to approve.
I'd like to remove the appointment from the consent agenda to allow for a roll call vote.
I agree. Second. I'll second that.
Okay, so we'll remove item D. I'll finish saying what that was. It was the approve the appointment of Donna Lascaglia, am I pronouncing it correct, as the director of the Public Works. And item E is 16.064. It's a petition to discontinue a portion of Elm Street, as Councilor Ryan referred to. So I'll accept a motion minus that one item to move the consent agenda.
Move it.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, then we'll move to item D then, which is this is to approve the appointment of Donald Lascaglia, and it'll trip off my tongue soon enough, I'm sure, as the director of Public Works. I'll accept a motion.
Accept that motion.
It should be recognized, as all of you witnessed, that this came with a unanimous recommendation from the Committee of City Services. So further discussion on the nomination.
Second.
Well, we got that part. Is there no further discussion? I just like to, I realize I did forget to say welcome. And then also to George's point, the issue of support. I think it's important. I think he makes a good point. It's a two-way street. It's not us all coming and begging for you or making demands on you. I think it's appropriate for you to also make demands on us and ask and explain to us how we can best support you going forward. And I think I'll be presumptuous and assume agreement from the rest of the council that we're inclined to do that. So that said, okay, no further discussion. There was a request for a roll call on this, so roll call please. This is to approve the appointment.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Well, that seems pretty darn unanimous. Welcome. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Into another recess. Actually, I would ask anyone, do you want a genuine recess? Do you want to take a little break?
Just a little.
So we'll go into full recess for about, 7 3/4 minutes or something like
that. How long?
7 3/4 minutes, precisely.
Till 10 of them.
We are coming out of recess, and then we're going to go into recess again. And that is to, in this case, to go to the Finance Committee meeting, which is chaired by Councilor Murphy, who will
call the meeting to order.
Exactly.
And we'll call our roll.
Councilor Carney?
Present.
Councilor LaBarge?
Present.
Councilor Murphy?
Here. And being that's all of us that there are at the moment, we'll get going with our financial orders. The first is 16081 to appropriate $39,353.78 for related infrastructure upgrades relative to the replacement of the city's voice over IP system. Order that the City Council appropriates $39,353.78 from the INET Access Technology Fund to be used for related infrastructure upgrades relative to the replacement of the city's voice over IP system and necessary to provide resiliency and redundancy for the city's vital public communication system. Do we have a motion in Finance?
Make a motion.
Second. Second.
Okay, and the mayor's here to talk about it.
Yeah, this is a project that's in the capital plan and you have voted some of the funding for it. This is actually, this funding we were waiting for it to arrive. This is a final fourth quarter payment that just arrived from Comcast and goes into that INET account, and so we want to quickly appropriate it to that project. This is actually the final payment under the old contract with Comcast from the previous year, which expired, well, was renewed in April. This is for what, February, March?
January,
February, March. So it's the final quarter of that particular contract. So again, the project is outlined in the capital plan, and we want to make sure that we get this money into that account so that we can fill it out for the entire project.
Mm-hmm. Any questions for the mayor?
No.
Then all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Great. All right, the next is 16082, in order to authorize Look Park to apply for a park grant and authorize related borrowing. Order that, in order to file and accept grants with and from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs for the Parkland Acquisition and Renovation Program for improvements to Look Memorial Park. Whereas Look Memorial Park is a city and region-wide asset, and park improvements are consistent with the priority for the recreation improvements and heritage landscape preservation in the Northampton Open Space and Recreation Multi-Trail Plan 2011 to 2018. And whereas Look Memorial Park was deeded to the city under management of a board of trustees with the condition that shall be ever used as a park and for no other purpose, thereby consistent with Article 97 of the amendments to the Massachusetts Constitution. And whereas planned Look Park improvements to their fountain, water spray park, and bathrooms and related energy and water efficiency improvements will enhance the recreation experience. And whereas the Executive Office of Environmental Affairs is offering reimbursable grants to cities and towns to support the preservation and restoration of urban parks through the Parkland Acquisition and Renovations for Communities Grant Park Program. The park is a reimbursement program which requires that the city demonstrate that it has all the funds necessary to improve the park properties prior to state reimbursement. Now, therefore, it be ordered that the City Council appropriates and authorizes the treasurer with the approval of the mayor to borrow $625,000 over 15 years under Mass General Law Chapter 44B subsection 11 and Mass General Law 44 subsection 8C or any other enabling authority for the purposes of improvement of public parks and playgrounds on said property, and that the mayor is authorized to file on behalf of the City of Northampton any and all applications deemed necessary for grants and or reimbursements from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts deemed necessary under the Park Act Chapter 933 Acts of 1977 as amended, or any other way connected with the scope of this article, and the mayor is authorized to enter into all agreements and execute any and all instruments as may be necessary on behalf of the City of Northampton to effect said renovation. And the mayor may be and is hereby authorized to take any such action necessary to carry out the terms, purposes, and conditions of this grant. Do we have a motion on this one?
Make a motion.
Second.
The mayor is here to speak about
this. Yes, so this is the very similar to the orders that we bring to you for the park grant program. This is an authorization that we do not intend to actually use. But we're doing it in order to improve the application's chances because it scores additional points. Sean Porter, the executive director of Look Park, is here tonight, and he can speak to some of the work that they want to do with this grant. And we did outline some of the projects, some of the capital projects that they want to work on. We did coordinate with Look Park and Parks and Rec and other city departments to figure out what was the project we would apply for in this round of park funding. And it was decided that this was a time to go forward with Look Park. They have received these kinds of grants in the past. And so, as you know, we've last couple of cycles we've done park grants for Pulaski Park, two in a row, and then some other park projects.
Bridge Street.
That was a separate grant. That was a separate playground grant. But we've certainly gotten them for Florence Fields and some of the other recreation areas as well. That's what we're asking for. Again, it's a borrowing authority that we will not use if they don't get the grant, and we'd ask for your consideration. And Sean is
about a motion.
Make a motion.
Recognize Park Rec.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Hi, I'm Sean Porter. I'm the director at Look Park. The mayor just introduced me. What we're looking to do is the authorization is for a borrowing authorization, but we have no intention of using it. The money will have to go through the city. The park would provide the money to the city, and then the city would write the checks. It's just the way the state grant has to work. We intend to replace the bathrooms, if you're familiar with the park, in the Westwoods area and the Dow area. They were built in the 1940s, not quite up to grade. We would like to put in things that are ADA accessible, reduce or eliminate the use of water, and are more electrically efficient. On top of that, the water spray park is over 20 plus years old, so we would like to replace that. Again, its water efficiency is not very good. There's parts that don't work anymore. The surfaces become deteriorated. So as a safety and environmental issue, we'd like to replace that as well. So we intend to use park funds to our Look Park funds through the city, have the city write the checks, and then we will be reimbursed for $400,000 of the project. And currently the projects look at about $656,000.
Questions?
No.
No questions. Thank you.
Oh, that was easy. Thank you.
Thank you.
If there's no more questions, all in favor of positive recommendation,
aye.
Say aye. Aye. Any opposed? No? Great.
I'm surprised you didn't make a shameless train plug while you were
Oh,
there.
I should have done a train plug.
Did you want to let the councilors know about that, though?
Yeah, that's worth knowing about.
Another capital project that we are currently in the process of is replacing the Look Park train. Those of you who have ridden the train, I assume pretty much everybody in the room. The train currently is over 30 years old, although it's logged in hours. If you do a math formula to that, it equals about 400,000 miles. It went down last year a few times, losing about a month's worth of service, so we are currently working on purchasing a new train. The new train should be arriving sometime in late June, so I hope you'll all come down and enjoy a ride on the train. We're also doing some fundraising, so if you'd like to help out, we also appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Questions at all?
Is the train going to look appreciably different than the?
It's going to be another CP Huntington train, same design, but the paint is going to be different on it, just to make it look a little more modern, a little more fun. And the cars themselves, the passenger cars, are not being replaced. It's the locomotive itself that costs $200,000.
Wow. Tracks are okay.
Tracks, we just did $20,000 worth of improvements over the past 2 or 3 years on the tracks.
Can you get it to serve as the shuttle to the Amtrak station?
That would be fun. Actually, that'd be really fun.
I'm from Leeds. It'd be nice if there was like a little shuttle that would.
We're going to New Haven.
That's a good idea.
Right. Thank you.
We're going to have to tear up that bike trail thingy we build.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Monorail.
I like that.
So now we move into CPC.
Did you vote on that order?
We did.
Okay,
yes, we did. So now Sarah's on. We're going to do CPC things now. This is 16083, an order to use CPA funds to restore two historic stained glass windows located in the First Churches of Northampton. Whereas the First Churches of Northampton submitted an application for Community Preservation Act funding for the restoration of 12 historic stained glass windows located in the sanctuary of First Churches of Northampton, whereas CPA funds will be used to restore an important historic resource that is valued by the community, the region, and on which Mass Historic holds permanent preservation restrictions. Whereas the project will enable these important historic artifacts to remain in Northampton, And whereas in addition to being an important historic resource, First Churches provides valuable social service meeting space to at least 27 different organizations and the community at large on a monthly basis. And whereas all the work will be consistent with the Secretary of the Interior Standards for the Treatment of Historic Properties, and whereas on April 20th, 2016, the Northampton Community Preservation Committee voted unanimously to recommend $213,000 in Community Preservation Act funds be used to support the restoration of the two stained glass windows, the Tiffany and Rose, that were included in the application. Now, therefore, it be ordered that the $213,000 be appropriated from Community Preservation Act funds to First Churches of Northampton for restoration of the Tiffany and Rose stained glass windows, and that the grantee meet conditions approved by the Community Preservation Commission, the Mayor, and the City Council. Specifically, $6,870.72 is appropriated from the CPA Historic Preservation Reserve, and $206,129.28 is appropriated from the CPA budgeted reserve. We have a motion on this one.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right. Sarah, looks like we have a PowerPoint fired up here.
We do. It works this time, I think, hopefully. So just as a quick introduction to all of the CPA recommendations, as you saw in the cover letter, the committee had some really tough decisions to make this round. There were some projects that were less than time sensitive that weren't funded at all this round, although they were really good projects, and others were only funded in part, and this happens to be one of them. So the First Church has submitted a larger application for restoration of many of the windows within the church. They're all really old, and they're all starting to deteriorate. The CPC is recommending funding for two of these, the Tiffany River of Life window, which you can see on the left side, which is a really beautiful and unique piece that faces Center Street, and the rose window that faces Main Street, which is seen in the front of the other photo. It's really visible from Main Street outside the church.
This one right here,
mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Are you waiting for questions?
I have a question. I have a constituent who wrote to me before the meeting who asked about the potential legal issue of a city donating money to a church, and I'm just wondering if that's, you understand how that works? And
yeah, absolutely. So this is being funded as a historic preservation project, which community preservation committees all around the state have done time and time again. This isn't the first time Northampton will be giving money either to a church or even to First Church as they paid for the roof. And it's there's clear case law that indicates that if something is an important community resource, which the committee really felt that First Churches is, then that's absolutely allowable.
Okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. To that point, because I flagged that as well. There's a historic preservation restriction on the window itself.
It's on the church as a whole,
the entire church,
which includes the window.
All right. And was that put on when the council appropriated CPA money in the past for other projects of the church?
It was related, but not as a direct result of that. So okay. Mass Historic also contributed some funds to First Churches for their roof repairs and required a preservation restriction that was held by the state as a result of that. So it's the same document, it's just someone else holding
right.
it.
I wanted to double check because I think it's, I mean, isn't the issue more than just it's, there's a historic value there, because you could argue almost every church in New England has historic value, but isn't the case that we wouldn't be allowed to just give money and not get anything in return? And that's what historic preservation restriction is. That's what we've got in return for doing this in the past.
Yes.
Otherwise, I mean, I think it's the anti-aid clause of the or amendment to the state constitution.
So were this not already protected by a permanent preservation restriction, then
right.
we absolutely would require that to be done at this point.
Right.
But there's no need to do that because Mass Historic always holds it.
All right. And I guess I just wanted to articulate that because I actually, again, flagged that as an issue. I think there is a distinction between supporting a religion and supporting a building, you know, wherein that and other activities may happen. But I think it is important that this restriction is on there, because otherwise it would be pretty questionable, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. So this window will remain in Northampton.
Right.
The church is required to maintain it, as well as the other windows. Anything that they do will require Mass Historic review.
Okay, thank you.
To that point, actually, the church has been struggling mightily trying to figure out how to preserve this window, and usually at the insistence of a lot of citizens who are concerned because of its historic value and its perceived historical value by the citizens. The other important thing to point out is First Church's is not unique so much in this respect, but is certainly notable in this respect as serving as a common space, a common congregate space, not just for religious services, but for community services, programming, and meetings, events that they frequently serve as a community hall and less as a church without promoting any religion, as it were. So I understand it's covered under law, but I think also under a less ambiguous sense, a more ambiguous sense is that actually as an asset to the community, it's unique in that respect. First Church stands as actually emblematic and iconic for the city of Northampton. It's also its history of and its relevance to the city has been significant. So all this seems to be in keeping.
And the committee discussed that quite at length as well, which is why they called out specifically how many service organizations are assisted by the church and are able to hold meetings there. And they also just really felt that it was an unbelievably important building to the history of Northampton. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the Tiffany window alone, I think, is appraised at $750,000, isn't it?
Somewhere around there. It's a very valuable piece.
It's a very valuable piece. It needs restoration. And because of the restrictions, they're required to maintain it, you know. So they're the stewards of this $750,000 window that they're responsible to maintain, but don't really have the resources to do it. So they really are kind of between a rock and a hard place without some help to take care of this. It's gorgeous if you've ever seen it. Councilor.
Not to belabor the point, but the preservation restriction protects the building, but it also limits what the church can do with that building. So mm-hmm. their hands are tied and must maintain this window. So. Mm-hmm. I'm grateful that we're recognizing the importance and the urgency of the work, because there is real urgency to protect it. It's in bad condition, and something could, you know, if some of the lead breaks more, it could, a lot of its value and importance could be lost. So,
and it will also likely be a lot more visible from both the interior and exterior when it is restored. A lot of that is just sort of grime that's built up over the years, which will be
on the outside. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes. Okay, they're going to attempt to get this money to restore the Tiffany in the Row stained glass. The church is absolutely beautiful. I can remember as a councilor and Councilor Carney, we did approve at one point the CPA money several years ago on restoration that needed to be done on that church. There is a tremendous historic value to the First Churches, and especially the meetings. That's where it is at. And that's what we heard when we approved the money several years ago for the First Churches. My question is, how are they going to get money to complete the rest of the stained glass windows?
That's something that the First Churches will need to be thinking about in the future. The committee made it pretty clear that that funding wouldn't be allocated for any of those smaller windows. So that's something that they'll need to be addressing in the future, but I don't know the exact plans.
Just absolutely beautiful.
Any other questions for Sarah on this one? Hearing no more questions, and all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
And I have to abstain on this one, so thank you for your support. The next one is 16084, an order to use CPA funds to add 22 acres to the Sawmill Hills in Leeds. Order that whereas the Northampton Conservation Commission and the Northampton Office of Planning and Sustainability submitted a CPA application for the Sawmill Hills to Water's Edge project. This will fund the purchase of 22-acre parcel adjacent to and overlooking the Roberts Meadow Reservoir for permanent protection. Whereas the parcel services an important wildlife connection that will preserve a natural link between the Sawmill Hills Conservation Area, Roberts Hill, and the Roberts Meadow Reservoir. And whereas the project meets the goal of the Sustainable Northampton Plan, Northampton Community Preservation Plan, and Open Space and Recreation Multi-Use Trail Plan to protect open space and provide for passive recreation. Whereas on April 20th, 2016, the Northampton Community Preservation Committee voted unanimously to recommend that $72,000 in Community Preservation Act funds be used to support this project. Now, therefore, it be ordered that $72,000 be appropriated from the Community Preservation Act funding to the Northampton Conservation Commission and Northampton Office of Planning and Sustainability for the Sawmill Hills to Water's Edge project, and that the grantee meets the conditions approved by the Community Preservation Committee, the mayor, and the council. Specifically, $72,000 is appropriated from the CPA budgeted reserve. Do we have a motion on this one?
Make a motion.
Second.
All right, so this is something the committee is already familiar with. Planning and Sustainability Director Wayne Fiden came to your last meeting to present this for first reading, and that was approved. Second reading is scheduled for later in the meeting. So this will connect to the existing network, which the other slide shows, and you can see that these parcels really sit in the middle of a lot of protected land and are really important to protect.
Questions?
Well, just a comment on how what a great resource the Sawmills Conservation Area is, the trails, the trail network, and anything that's done to enhance that property and to improve that, I think, is serves the citizens of Northampton very well.
Mm-hmm. Any other comment? Hearing none. Oh, Marianne, sorry.
The area is just absolutely beautiful.
Yeah.
And my husband, born and raised in Leeds, and I've seen that so many times, and I am so glad that we are going to go ahead and conserve this property.
And all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No? Great. 16086, in order to use CPA funds towards the purchase price of a house in Northampton. 8 units of housing and support services for unaccompanied homeless youth. Order that whereas the Friends of Hampshire County Homeless Individuals submitted an application for Community Preservation Act funding for the Housing for Homeless Youth Project, and whereas currently this population faces a gap in supportive housing services in Northampton nearby, despite being a high-risk group, and whereas Western Massachusetts Network to End Homelessness has declared unaccompanied homeless youth as a priority for our region, whereas CPA funds will leverage up to $475,000 of funds from other sources. And whereas on April 20th, the Northampton Community Preservation Committee voted unanimously to recommend $275,000 in Community Preservation Act funds be used to support this project. And whereas CPA funds will be used towards the purchase of a building and operation will be turned over to an experienced service organization for management. Now, therefore, it be ordered the $275,000 be appropriated from Community Preservation Act funding to Friends of Hampshire County Homeless Individuals for the Housing of Homeless Youth Project for the creation of 6 to 8 affordable housing units, and that the grantee meets the conditions approved by the Community Preservation Committee, the mayor, and the City Council. Specifically, $150,000.10 is appropriated from the CPA Affordable Housing Reserve, and that $24,999.90 is appropriated from the CPA budgeted reserve. Do we have a motion on this one?
Make a motion.
Second.
All right, so there is no existing resource like this in the area at all. Youth that transition out of foster care and other programs have a very, very high risk of becoming homeless and then staying homeless, and this project will help to fill that gap. Friends of Hampshire County Homeless Individuals doesn't know the exact site that they'll be using, so I used 2 photos of other very successful homeless projects in Northampton. That's about it for this one.
Questions? Counselor?
Yes. What is the building that they want to buy? Where is it located?
They don't have one nailed down. They're down to a few that they're thinking about, but they don't know exactly which one they'll be using. But regardless, their budget will remain the same.
Do you know who the service agent will be?
Yes, that will be Dial Self, which has been successful in Franklin County and has a
Thank
very
good.
Other questions on this one? Hearing none, then all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye. Did you skip over the Academy of Music?
Mm-hmm.
I have it in my file before.
Item 16.085.
Yeah. There's a curtain. Yeah. So, As mentioned, 16085, use CPA funds to allow the Academy of Music to restore a scenic curtain. Order that whereas the Academy of Music submitted a CPA application to restore curtain preservation, and whereas the 1913 Maurice Tuttle curtain is the largest known historic scene curtain on the East Coast and represents a scene from Northampton history, and whereas restoration of the curtain would allow it to be viewed by visitors to the Academy during events and free historic tours, and whereas on April 20th, the Northampton Community Preservation Committee voted unanimously to recommend that $44,785 in community preservation funds be used to support the project. Now, therefore, it be ordered that $44,785 be appropriated from the Community Preservation Act Fund to the Academy of Music for the Historic Curtain Preservation Project, and that the grantee meet the conditions approved by the Community Preservation Committee, the Mayor, and the Council, specifically that $44,785 is appropriated from the CPA budgeted reserve.
Move approval.
Second.
Okay.
All right. So last year, this curtain was found stapled to the back of the Academy's main stage curtain. No one had any idea that it was there. They took it down for cleaning and some repairs, and someone said, well, let's remove it from this piece in the back, and they found this amazing scenic curtain, which depicts Paradise Pond and the hoe shop, which burned down about 100 years ago. And the pictures just absolutely don't do it justice because of its size and the lighting in the Academy. It's really difficult to get a good photo. It's something that really has to be seen in person. But if you go see it, you'll definitely agree it's something that should be preserved and remain in the Academy.
Mm-hmm. Questions?
Mm-hmm. I'm just curious what you mean. It was stapled to the back of the curtain that's in use?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it would go, the main stage curtain that goes up and down, yeah, had this stapled to the back of it sort of as a frame. Wow. Which isn't uncommon, but the Academy didn't know that it was there.
Have you been able to find any like documentation or references to it, any historic documents or?
There are some newspaper articles that reference the curtain and the hoe shop. And Maurice Tuttle was a pretty well-known historic curtain designer, so it's neat that this was designed by him, and he was part of the Northampton Players about 100 years ago. That's nice. Really neat part of Northampton's history.
It's beautiful.
Other questions?
Just to observe that this is—it's very cool. I think it's fantastic to that it's in condition that I assume will accept restoration and.
Yes, it will. Part of the degradation is because it was stapled to the main stage curtain for so long. It's got these heavy wooden and steel frames that have been pulling on it for years, and it didn't have a whole lot left to go before it would have been irreparably damaged.
That's great.
Unbelievable.
Wonderful discovery. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation.
Aye.
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 All right. Next is 16087. In order to provide CPA funds that will be used for fast action on time-sensitive real estate opportunities near and dear to my heart. Order that whereas the Northampton Conservation Commission submitted an application for Community Preservation Act funding for a conservation fund, and whereas the fund makes possible increased acquisition or protection of open space parcels in Northampton by supporting fast action on time-sensitive opportunities, and whereas the project may leverage additional public and or private funds, and whereas the project meets the goal of the Northampton Sustainability Plan for the protection of open space and agricultural lands, whereas the applicant has used these funds effectively in the past towards the protection of several hundred acres of open space reflecting the goals established by the Community Preservation Committee, and whereas all land purchases will be reviewed and approved by the Conservation Commission and the City Council, and whereas on April 20th, 2016, the Northampton Community Preservation Committee voted unanimously to recommend $30,000 in Community Preservation Act funds be used to support this project. Now, therefore, it be ordered that $30,000 be appropriated from the Community Preservation Act funds to the Northampton Conservation Fund, and that the grantee meets the conditions approved by the Community Preservation Committee, the Mayor, and City Council. Specifically, the $30,000 is appropriated from the CPA budgeted reserve. We have a motion.
Make the motion.
Second.
So there's no photo for this one, but we could have included basically any picture of recently preserved open space in Northampton, because this fund allows the Conservation Commission to quickly do the due diligence that it needs to act on open space opportunities. So title searches, surveys, environmental assessments, anything that's needed prior to the purchase of a property.
Questions?
We go through this.
I think this is the
we
tense
do this all the time. Okay, because what it is, it's like quick trick. okay? If there's real estate out there, we can move quickly on it.
Exactly.
It hasn't changed.
Other questions? Hearing none. Positive recommendation. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Good. Next is 16088, an order to use CPA funds to allow BBC to continue efforts to control and eliminate. That's control and eliminate several different species of invasive plants that are damaging critical habitat essential to the health of native wildlife plants, including endangered species. This is the Broadbrook Coalition. Order that, whereas the Broadbrook Coalition submitted an application for Community Preservation Act funding for continued removal of invasive plants within the Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area, whereas the main targets of this project are spotted and brown knapweed on the dam and in Cook's Pasture, glossy buckhorn in Cook's Pasture, and black swallowwort in Cook's Pasture. Whereas the project control and removal of invasive plants meets the goals established by the Northampton Open Space and Recreation and Multi-Use Trail Plan and Rediscovering Northampton, which will protect habitat areas where endangered plant species. And whereas the applicant has used these funds effectively in the past, and whereas on April 20th, 2016, the Northampton Preservation Committee voted unanimously to recommend $12,800 in community preservation funds be used to support this project. Now, therefore, it be ordered that $12,800 be appropriated from the Community Preservation Act funds to the Fitzgerald Lake Invasive Plant Eradication Project, and that the grantee meets the conditions approved by the Community Preservation Committee, the Mayor, and the Council. Specifically, $12,800 is appropriated from the CPA budgeted reserve. Motion?
Make a motion.
Okay. Second. All right, so as councilors heard during the public comment from members of the Broadbrook Coalition, this project will allow BBC to continue the important work it's been doing for a lot of years now at this point to remove invasive species that are threatening these unique and interesting habitats. And these species were identified by Lori Sanders in her recent Rediscovering Northampton update as things that were really threatening a great plant community there.
Questions? All in favor of a positive recommendation, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. 16089, in order to use funds to conduct dendrochronology wood dating study of the Shepherd Barn. Order that, whereas Historic Northampton Inc. submitted an application for Community Preservation Act funding to restore, renovate, and stabilize the Shepherd Barn at 66 Bridge Street and protect historic artifacts, and that the application was revised to address a small portion of necessary documentation before the project can begin, and whereas CPA funds will be used to complete dendrochronology research and secure the barn in preparation for full restoration, and whereas CPA funds will be used to help secure an important historic resource that is valued by the community in the region on which the city holds a permanent preservation restriction, and whereas all the work will be consistent with the Secretary of the Interior standards for the treatment of historic properties, and whereas on April 20th, the Northampton Community Preservation Committee voted unanimously to recommend that $2,300 in community preservation funds be used to support the project. Now, therefore, it be ordered that $2,300 be appropriated from the Community Preservation Act funding to Historic Northampton, Inc. for dendrochronology and immediate stabilization work at the Shepherd Barn, and that the grantee meets the conditions approved by the Community Preservation Commission, the Mayor, and the Council. Specifically, the $2,300 is appropriated from the CPA budgeted reserve. Do we have a motion on this one?
Make a motion.
Second. So Historic Northampton submitted an application for full and complete restoration to the barn, but due to the tight funding round and also their construction schedule, which wouldn't have allowed any work to take place this year, they reduced their request to $2,300 for this necessary dendrochronology study. So dendrochronology is when you drill into a tree or a piece of wood, and the size of the rings allows you to figure out how old the barn is, and that's necessary before the full restoration project can begin. And presently, Historic Northampton doesn't know the exact construction date of the barn.
Questions? Hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It looks like our last one. 16090. In order to use CPA funds to continue design and construction of Pulaski Park. Order that, Whereas the Northampton Department of Public Works submitted an application for Community Preservation Act funding for continued work towards the renovation of Pulaski Park, specifically the overlook expansion and the area to the rear of the Academy of Music. And whereas Pulaski Park is an important downtown resource and the project will create a vibrant downtown green space. And whereas the project meets the goals of Sustainable Northampton Plan and the Open Space Recreation and Multi-Use Plans. And whereas the Department of Public Works received extensive public input about the design of the park and the selected design reflects that process. And whereas the City Council and CPA in 2013, 14, and 15 granted $1,898,500 in CPA funds to support the design and development of design plans and construction for the project, which broke ground in the fall of 2015. And whereas on May 4th, 2016, the Northampton Community Preservation Committee voted unanimously to recommend $805,400 in CPA funds used to support this phase of the project. Now, therefore, it be ordered that $805,400 be appropriated from the Community Preservation Act funding to the Northampton Department of Public Works for additional funding for the Pulaski Park renovation project for the overlook expansion to the area rear of the Academy, and that the grantee meets the conditions approved by the Community Preservation Committee, the Mayor and Council. Specifically, the $130,400 is appropriated from the CPA budget reserve, and that the City Treasurer, with the approval of the Mayor, is authorized to borrow $675,000 over 10 years under Mass General Law, Chapter 44B, Subsection 11, or any other enabling authority, and that the debt repayment is appropriated from the CPA budgeted reserve. Motion on this one?
So moved.
All right.
So last but not least, by any means, this is a project that the council is very familiar with. The first phase is already underway, just over there, as everybody has seen. And this current phase will allow for the full design and construction of the overlook portion of the park and the area to the rear of the Academy. And this phase will create new usable park space on the hillside between the park and the roundhouse lot, which is currently completely unusable.
So this will provide access down the hill?
It will. Access as well as park space that people can enjoy.
Questions?
Comment? Please. The salient feature that you described here is actually, it creates, it converts a cliff into an accessible, usable space, and makes it create the separation here of the city is sort of rivened in half by the fact that there is this cliff that's here that's and this park is ADA grade. It will it has a series of, as you can see, switchbacks. It will also have a bike access as well, and it will be graded down to the parking lot. And it's this is one of the one of the big appealing features of the particular of Pulaski Park design, and it opens up a dimension of the city that's been considered unapproachable, and also makes this parking lot a lot more appealing and more accessible and safer.
Mm-hmm. Any other councilor?
I was just going to add that at the public forum that the Community Resources Committee held on downtown economy just this last Monday, there were three or four recurring themes, and one of those was that one of the ways that downtown needs to be more successful, can be even more successful, is to place more of an emphasis on drawing people by way of festivals and events, and that's one of the things that we need to do to keep it vibrant for our own citizens and for others coming to from elsewhere. And this is a place at long last where some of that activity can happen. So I think it's wonderful that as a city we're investing in this tremendous central space, and I think it has amazing potential for activity in the years ahead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was at the meeting where excuse me, this idea was revealed, and it was just this unbelievable moment where we recognized we could reclaim the space and make it usable for the city. And and it's exciting now with the visual barrier coming down and be able to see the benches coming in, and the excitement over this redesigned Pulaski Park is palpable in the city right now. And just the idea that we have a second phase that will continue to make this usable public space is really remarkable.
Councilor?
Yes. Do you know if they have moved a capsule, maybe mayor? Because I have a report that...
Yeah, I've spoken with that resident extensively. And no, the time capsule has not been disturbed. There was a time capsule that was placed in 1976 for the last time the park was dedicated. It's actually an old Cole Morgan periscope. So it's would be difficult to damage. And so we do have it located, and we know exactly where it is. 2076, when we all gather to open it, it's there. So yeah, I have spoken to that particular resident extensively, before he passed away, former Mayor Kramer spent a lot of time with me and actually shared with me a lot of documents. I actually have the program from that opening ceremony that he shared with me. He was mayor in when the park was last renovated and last opened. It's one of the great sadnesses for me that we lost Mayor Kramer, because it would have been great to have had him be at the grand opening of Pulaski Park. We have it. We even have a GPS. I don't know if there'll still be GPS in 2076. I suspect there'll be something like that. But we know where it is, and we are going to have a modification of. We're actually going to use the plaque that originally was just sitting on a rock in the park, and we're going to be installing that on another rock that's a feature of the park to show people where that time capsule is located. So, yeah.
Reference to grand opening. What is our time?
Well, we are. Steven Stimson was out there today on site. There was a little bit of a delay with some of the metal fabrication. Our goal is to try to. It's still June. That was always been the time frame. And so we're there, as you can see, they were actually out there last weekend. They're really moving along fast now. Soil's going in, plantings are going in. A lot of the brickwork has been done. The children's play area is amazing. They built this, it's a slide that's made out of the biggest piece of Goshen stone you've ever seen. It's like, that's a slide basically for kids to slide on. I see a scared mom, but it'll be really fun. The other big piece that they're working on now, people may have heard jackhammering of sorts, but they literally took a big piece of Goshen stone and basically by hand with electric chisels kind of carved the bowl out of it that's going to be the water feature, which you can sort of see now. It's sort of prominently sitting there, but they're doing a lot of the underground work now for the feature of the park that's like a stormwater retention natural feature that's going to take water. If you're out at the curb, you can actually see there's a curb cut next to the storm drain. And so excess water that doesn't go into the storm drain is going to flow through this feature of the park. I'm going to be filtered naturally through a sort of a, not really a rain garden, but through a channel that's going to help process the water. People may have seen, it looked like, look like milk crates that are stacked out there. Those are actually part of the detention system that's going to be buried underground. So they are they're fully deployed, and we're trying to get it get the first parts of it open so we can start to open parts of the park. And then obviously the second phase of construction, that's going to be an interesting logistical project to work on, just because of the amount of soil and fill that's going to have to come in, and parking and all those other sorts of things. But it's moving along. We're working on trying to do a grand opening. The other decision we've made is to we're going to actually sod big parts of the park, as opposed to doing. We're going to hydro seed some of the out of the way places, but for the main lawn, we're going to sod it just so that it's not. We're not planting grass and saying stay off of it for 2 or 3 months. So it's going to really start to pop in the next few weeks. So it's very exciting to see it happen. And I appreciate the council's support. And obviously we are hopeful we get this funding. We did get another park grant for this overlook that's supporting this overlook project as well. So the council funding that we're asking for tonight, Together with that second park grant will help us fund phase two, so we can hopefully open the main park and then begin to roll into phase two. Right. So, yeah.
So, any other questions? All in favor of a positive recommendation from finance, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Excellent. Next is 16091, an order to allow the city of Northampton's tree warden to accept gifts of tangible personal property with a fair market value of $25,000 or less. Order that, whereas the city of Northampton recognizes the role that public shade trees play in reducing energy use, improving air quality, and mitigating stormwater, spawning retail activity and enhancing quality of life. And whereas the public wishes to supplement the city's effort by providing donations of trees and tree-related equipment and supplies. And whereas Mass General Law Section 44, subsection 53A and a half provides that acceptance of gifts of tangible property requires a vote of the city council and approval of the mayor. And whereas it's in the best interest of the city to streamline the process by which gifts up to a certain value may be accepted and placed in service for the community. Now, therefore, it be ordered the City Council authorizes the City of Northampton's tree warden with the approval of the mayor to accept gifts of tangible personal property with a fair market value of $25,000 or less from the federal government, a charitable foundation, a private corporation, or similar statutory entity, individual, or from the Commonwealth or any political subdivision thereof. Tree warden shall use such gifts for the restricted purpose provided by the donor, or if no restriction is attached to the gift, for such purposes as the tree warden deems advisable. Do we have a motion on this one?
Move approval.
Second.
Second.
All right.
The council may recall that we brought forward similar orders for the police department and for the school department, setting a threshold by which the police chief and/or the school superintendent could accept certain gifts. And so we want to do a similar order for the tree warden, because we do occasionally receive gifts of trees, and in some cases that they're part of developments. Sometimes they're just gifted from nurseries, etc. We'd like the tree warden to have the ability to accept them, up to that same $25,000 threshold, and not have to, because literally under Mass General Law, if I want to donate a tree, by the letter of the law, they have to come and have the approval of the mayor and city council in order to accept that. So this just gives a sort of a blanket authority to accept gifts up to a certain amount.
Questions? None. So all in favor of positive recommendation, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And our last one, 16092, an order to rescind a TIF previously granted to the Grantham Group. Order that whereas on March 7, 2013, the city council granted a tax increment financing plan to the Grantham Group for the assisted living project known as Christopher Heights, and whereas the vote authorized the mayor to execute and implement a TIF agreement, and that agreement was not executed by mutually agreement of the city and Grantham Group, and whereas the Commonwealth has requested that the city rescind its authorization for this purpose, therefore be it ordered that a vote taken by the council on March 7, 2013 to grant a TIF to the Grantham Group is hereby rescinded. Do we have a motion?
Second.
Okay.
Yeah, this is just a paperwork requirement that the state is insisting upon. We had a little back and forth on it. But basically, when Christopher Heights was first being proposed, we initially attempted to structure a TIF agreement together with some CPA funds. That's what they had requested. It ended up that the Department of Housing and Community Development didn't actually like that arrangement. So we ended up, I ended up not executing the TIF, and then we ended up switching and just giving them all of the funding in CPA format. And then ultimately DHCD approved their low-income housing tax credits. Because we didn't execute the TIF, I didn't ever enter into it. They've never been given a TIF. Nothing's ever happened. But the state seems singularly obsessed with that there's still this order out there, and I might give them a TIF or something. I don't know. So they would like us to take a vote to just rescind it, rescind the TIF that was never given. And so I said I would do that. So that's what this order is for. I actually would, if the council would be willing to have two readings, I would appreciate that. They have a meeting of their board that meets quarterly on the 27th, and they'd like me to get this to them by the 27th. Since it's a rescission, hopefully it will not create an issue on to take two readings. So,
questions for the mayor on this one? Hearing none, then all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
And that completes our agenda. So a motion to adjourn finance.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, we come out of recess and go back to the regular meeting. And let's take it from the top. Item 16081, this is to appropriate $39,353.78. Related infrastructure upgrades relative to replacement of the city's voiceover IP system. First reading.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion? Ready when you are.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes. Item 16, and that passes in first reading. Item 16.082, financial order to authorize Look Park to apply for a park grant and authorize related borrowing for.
Move to approve it.
Second.
Discussion on this item. Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
This is the financial orders regarding the Community Preservation Committee's recommendations for funding. First reading, I don't know if you want to move them as a group.
I would move them as a group unless there's an objection to any of them.
I'd like to remove the Fitzgerald Lake based on plan control.
So that's item 16.088 removed from the group, but the remainder, is there a second on that motion?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye. This is
aye.
To
take them as a group.
Take them as a group.
Aye.
Okay. Opposed? Okay. Any further discussion on these items? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Okay. Pass them first reading. This next up is the 16.088 that was removed. Fitzgerald Lake Invasive Plant Control, Rubber Coalition, $12,800.
Move approval.
Second. Discussion? Councilor Klein.
I just remain committed to not voting yes for the use of CPA funds for the use of herbicides and pesticides. I think the city can do better than that. I think that we can find very creative ways to address invasive plant control. I have deep and great respect for Broadbrook Coalition and for the people affiliated with it, all of the board members, and I just, in good conscience, can't vote yes on using pesticides there and using CPA funding for it.
Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
No.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
That passes in first reading as well. On to D, 16091, a financial order to allow the city's tree warden to accept gifts of $25,000 or less. First reading.
Move to approve.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Passes in first reading.
I think, did he want a second reading?
Next one. This one coming up.
Oh.
This is item 16.092. This is the order to rescind the TIF previously granted to the Grantham Group. First reading, I'll accept the motion.
Move to approve.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Move to suspend rules.
Motion's made to suspend rules. And it's seconded. Any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed?
Move second reading.
Second.
Motion's made. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Cole.
Yes.
Councilor Fine.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Okay, that passes in two readings. Item 16.060, this is a financial order regarding budgetary transfers between various departments. This is a second.
Second.
Approved.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Okay, it passes in second reading. Item 16.063 is the financial order to authorize the payment of a prior fiscal year bill for Smith Vocational and Agricultural School in the amount of $8,135.26.
Move to approve.
Second.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Next up, 16.066 is the order to purchase land off Reservoir Road.
Second.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shearer?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. Item 16.068, this is the order to purchase 55 plus or minus acres located between Glendale and West Hampton Roads. It's the second reading. I'll accept a motion.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shearer?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Next up on this item, I neglected to mention when it came to reiterate the fact that it came with a failed recommendation from Finance Committee, but on the last vote. But here we have item 16.069. This is the order to authorize the purchase of 110 plus or minus acres to add to the broad the Brookwood Marsh Conservation Area. In the second reading, I'll accept it.
Move to approve. Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion on this item? Councilor Bidwell.
This was the order that 2 weeks ago I voted against along with Councilor Murphy. But since then, we've had a chance to meet with Wayne Fiden, and I'm convinced it makes sense. I now better understand the nature and the location of the vernal pools on the property, the extent of endangered species habitat. Laurie Sanders describes it as one of the most ecologically and historically significant properties in Northampton. That carries some weight for me. But also, importantly, we were able to figure out where there can be several more appropriately located housing sites, including sites for hopefully affordable housing, without compromising the conservation values of the property. So I think it's a really good compromise between the right type of development and the right type of conservation. So I will now support it.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes. Thank you.
Passes in second. This is item 16.071, financial order to appropriate $32,356.31. I keep wanting to say gluten-free cash, but general fund free cash, the Northampton Public Schools for federal E-rate to support technology and infrastructure. Second reading.
Move approval.
Second.
Discussion on this. Roll call.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shearer?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Item 16.072, the financial order to rescind borrowing authority for the land for land off East Hampton Road previously approved in August 2015. Second reading.
Move approval.
Second.
Second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
That passes the second reading. Item 16.076, this is to appropriate $9,850 from the general fund free cash for technical assistance to analyze broadband services.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made. Second. Discussion. Roll call, please.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Moving this into orders. This is also a second reading. Item 16.065. This is an order to surplus property and authorize the mayor to transfer the property to the USA for the inclusion in the Conte Fish and Wildlife Refuge. Second reading.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made in second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Next up, 16.067. This is the order authorizing the mayor to waive and decline the city's right of first refusal on property located on Rocky Hill Road. Second reading.
Second.
Motion's made in second. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LeBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Now we come into ordinances. All in first reading. Not all. Most. Item 16.025. This is an ordinance regarding parking on Center Street. And this is, as I said, the first reading. So let's see. Hang on a sec. Up here. This is relative to parking near the police station on Center Street. Section 1, that the chapter 312-104 of section 312-104 of the Code of Ordinance be amended as follows. Strike Center Street northerly 15 minutes, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Saturday. 0.179 feet easterly from center court, 0.197 easterly from center court, and then instead replace it with 15 minutes, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Saturday, at a distance of 161 feet easterly from center court and a 0.179 feet easterly from center court. And then section 2 to include Center Street northerly, a point of 179 feet easterly from center court, and a point 197 feet easterly from center court. Accept a motion?
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made second. Any, you want to speak to this?
Yeah, if I can. this emerged in the Transportation Parking Commission. It was brought up by the chief of police. What this ordinance does is remove a parking space immediately next to the entrance to the police department parking area, which is currently a 15-minute space, and it makes the next space over a 15-minute space. So it preserves a 15-minute space and removes one space. The reason for it is the police department tells us they're having difficulty getting emergency vehicles in and out, often very quickly, at that location, and that's why, you know, sight lines and that kind of thing. And that if the parking space were not there, they would have an easier time doing that, which is kind of important. The debate in the Transportation Parking Commission was about, you know, can we afford to lose parking spaces downtown? It's not something we want to do lightly, but it was ultimately a unanimous vote for me and probably for others, pretty much going on the recommendation of the chief of police. This is something that she feels the department needs, and so the ordinance advanced for that reason.
Any further discussion? Okay, this is the first reading. Roll call, please.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Okay, that's the first reading. Will be revisited at our next meeting. 16.061, this is an ordinance to establish 2 one-hour parking spaces in Florence on Main Street. And I think it's usually more informative if it actually is explained to us rather than me reading chapter and verse, which is really confusing to anyone trying to follow along. So if everyone's okay with that?
Yes.
Okay. Then I would defer to the chair of Transportation Department.
Thank you. This simply adds two spaces right near Chestnut Street on Main Street in Florence, right in front of the bank. There's been lots of discussion with business owners and about the need for more parking and, you know, in that part of Florence generally. I generally do a hard time parking in Florence myself, but there is space for these two spots there, and it's been duly measured and analyzed by our traffic engineer, and so it makes sense to add them, adding two spaces.
And it is my intention, even though probably not required, but I'm just to be safe, I'm going to abstain on this vote. Okay, any other discussion?
Should I move the question?
Oh, I'm sorry, it's a motion?
Having explained it, yeah, move approval.
Second. Okay.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor
LaBarge? Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shera?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Item 16.061, an ordinance to establish to 16.062, an ordinance to add a yield sign at Venturers Field Road. First reading. I'll accept a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Once again, I'll defer to
this. There is a yield sign there currently, so we're just adding it to the code. There was discussion in the Transportation Parking Commission about that intersection, which is Henry Street and Montview and Ventures Field. It's kind of a strange amalgam of streets coming together at bizarre angles. And there were residents curious about possibly adding a stop sign. So we've been discussing that. And we didn't reach a conclusion on doing that. But in the process of doing the research, we realized that, you know, this is missing from the code. So it's a technical thing.
It's one of those.
Yeah.
Signs
just for fun.
Up once upon a time.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Back in the day when we could put signs up, each counselor had their own signs that they could put where they want in their ward.
Okay. Well, good old days.
Yeah. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shera?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Passes in first reading. Next time we revisit it at our next meeting. The last order, 16.034. This is the ordinance pertaining to water resources, the privatization, anti-privatization, let's call it, order. Accept a motion on this for second reading.
Move approval.
Okay. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call.
Oh,
I'm sorry. I missed that. Councilor LaBarge.
Yes. I just want to thank you, Council President, for getting a hold of our city solicitor in regards to my concerns of our last city council meeting and question of getting that answer, and I thank you.
There was... You'll recall there was a question that was brought up about the legitimacy or the legality of this particular ordinance by the former Councilor Adams. And it was requested that I seek an opinion from the city solicitor. And actually, it would make sense that I actually, given the fact that it was called into question, I think it's probably better read his opinion. You've requested my opinion as to whether the proposed ordinance entitled Public Ownership and Control of Water Resources, the ordinance which passed in first reading on May 5th, 2016, is within the authority of the City Council to enact in accordance with the Northampton City Charter. For the reasons that follow, my opinion is that the ordinance is within the legislative powers of the Council. The ordinance states as follows. The public water resources and infrastructure of the City of Northampton, including systems and facilities related to the supply, storage, treatment, and distribution of water, shall be owned or leased by the City of Northampton and controlled by the City of Northampton. Such resources and infrastructure shall not be sold, leased, or transferred into private ownership or control. We go back to his opinion. The charter provides for a complete separation of powers between an executive branch headed by a mayor and a legislative branch consisting of a city council. Section 1-3. The legislative branch may never exercise any executive power, and the mayor may never exercise any legislative power. In a strong mayor form of city government, quote, the city council's authority is limited to largely to check on the mayor's executive function through the power of appropriation. This is from the City Council of Boston versus the Mayor of Boston, 383 Massachusetts. In addition to the council's charter-based authority, the state legislature has vested certain functions in municipal legislative bodies. One of those statutes, Mass General Law, Chapter 40, Section 15A, requires a vote of the city council in order to authorize the sale of real estate. Harris v. the Town of Wayland. Another statute, Mass General Law, Chapter 40, Section 3, requires a council vote in order to lease real estate. The ordinance deals specifically with the sale or lease of real estate and thus is a matter squarely within the statutory authority of the council as the city's legislative branch. The ordinance would also not transgress the separation of powers. Nothing in the ordinance would invade the discretion vested in the mayor by the charter. Compare Section 280-C, subsection C, of the Stormwater and Flood Control Utility Ordinance as initially drafted, which would have dictated the line item for the stormwater utility in the mayor's future proposed budget submitted under Section 7-3 of the Charter. Such a provision would have intruded on the discretion of the mayor to determine his or her budget recommendations based upon the conditions prevailing at the time. The ordinance has no similar provision. Moreover, the ordinance would not dictate the operational policies or procedures of an executive department. Compare the proposed trust ordinance, which would have dictated the operational and policy and procedure of police officers handling detainer requests. Such a provision would have violated Charter Section 2-3, subsection B, prohibiting the city council or any member of the city council from giving quote, orders or directions to any employee of the city appointed by the mayor, either publicly or privately, close quote. The power to determine operational policies is vested solely in the mayor, who is mandated to, quote, exercise general supervision and direction over all city agencies unless otherwise provided by law or by this charter. That's section 3.2. The ordinance does not purport to impose any limitations on the mayor or any executive department. While I understand that the sale or lease of the water system is not currently under consideration, should the ordinance pass, the Director of Public Works would remain free to recommend to the mayor that the water system be sold or leased, and the mayor would be free to file proposed legislation repealing the ordinance along with a proposed order authorizing the sale or lease. The council would then be free to pass or reject those measures. This process would be fully consistent with the separation of powers envisioned by the charter. Please let me know if you have any think further in this regard. All right. So, any other discussion, Councilor Shara?
I just want to thank Councilor O'Donnell for being forward-thinking and creative about protecting this very basic but most necessary natural resource. That here in Northampton we are blessed to have, but also to have in very high quality. So, thank you for that.
Thank you, Councilor. Any other?
I just appreciated the very clear and logical opinion from council.
As did I. Thank you. Yeah. Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Yes.
That passes in second reading. And guess where that brings us?
To the end.
That to the bitter end. I'll accept a motion to adjourn.
Sure. Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you all very much.
Okay. All right.